a tough man. To let him live is taking a chance.
Since he knows our secret, he has to be killed.
Terry Segori, 6'6" of half-breed fury. But he's got a little problem. He has a hard time making friends.
You tell that bitch who sent you here how sorry I am I can no longer be her friend.
That I am an amateur at only because I just can't get anybody to pay me for it. You know?
That's
like,
a good...
Like masturbation, okay?
Yeah.
I mean, after 52 years, I am sure I can masturbate in the professional heavyweight league, you know, but I have not gotten anybody to pay me to masturbate.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
But I've trained. I've totally trained.
Yeah. I have trained as well. This is episode 60 of the podcast. If it sounds weird the way I'm talking, I am wearing a Spider-Man mask.
Ah, cool.
Just trying to change. Trying to change it up. This is episode 60 of the podcast. You know how sometimes, you know, you wake up and you're ready to start this Wednesday, but maybe halfway through the day you realize, oh shit, it's Tuesday.
Yeah.
I thought it was Wednesday this whole time. I thought for sure this was episode 59 we were going to do.
Oh yeah? No.
Yeah, I don't know where I got hung up, where I had the hiccup. But I thought for sure that this was episode 59. It wasn't until I watched the beginning of last week's Kill Bill episode that I... Oh, wait a second. We already did... Oh, so this next episode is episode 60. Well, shit. I had no freaking clue. And let me tell you something. The trailer for Kill Bill does not do it justice.
No.
That trailer for Kill Bill really does make it seem like Quentin Tarantino has lost his edge and is simply making like your typical bland action movie.
Mm-hmm. It does.
Seems so bland as opposed to the amazing movie that it actually is. Really weird. Weird trailer. So we've got a lot to talk about here in the beginning. I have a list here in the beginning.
Mm.
I've actually got two lists here. Well, three if you count my list of favorite lines from the Street Fighter.
Okay.
But I've got some lists here, some things I wanted to talk about. I was talking with Emerald the other day, and I said, Emerald, I need some more things to talk about in the beginning of the podcast. And Emerald, being Emerald, she just rolled her eyes and said, well, Dad, why don't you try talking about, I don't know, the movie? It's like, oh, you do not understand the world of entertainment. We do an intro, a bit of monologue, bit of jest,
uh-huh,
little bit of current events, and then we move to the desk.
Yes.
It's not like Seth Meyers goes, hi, I'm Seth Meyers. We're just going to bring out Kim Kardashian now and talk to her. It's a buildup. It's a buildup.
That's right.
She didn't get it.
That's right. We have studied the masters.
We have. Okay?
Johnny Carson, Merv Griffith,
Joan
Dinah River. Shore,
Chevy Chase.
Yes. Alan Thick.
Arsenio Hall. The masters. I like to consider my kids to be part of my dog pound.
Oh, you do?
Okay. To. Yeah. Cool. That I can go to. They're my dog pound. One of the things I wanted to talk about is currency. I think that it's funny. I just realized something. And I think it's funny. So let me explain it to you. Here's the sitch.
Okay.
Here's the sitch. That's a reference to Kim Possible.
Okay.
It's a Disney cartoon. I hate Kim Possible. You hate Kim Possible? You used to love Kim Possible. You never liked the naked mole rat dance? At all, Bella? Come on. So here's the sitch. Uh-huh. In the beginning of 2015, the government started saying that maybe we should put a woman on our currency.
Yes.
There was a talk about it. There was a build up to it. Maybe we should put a woman on some of our money. I'd put a woman on a bill, on one of our bills here in Americania. In the island of Americania.
Yeah.
So, but in order to put a woman on a bill, we'd have to kick someone out of the bill. So there was so that was the big, who is it going to be? Who are we going to kick out?
Yeah.
Who are we going to kick off a currency? Oh, well, let's go through the bills and let's see who we should kick out. Should we kick out this person? No, founding father. He's a brilliant person. People would go nuts. We kick him out. What about this person? Oh, we can't kick this person out. The person's huge. This person, there'd be riots in the streets. We kick this person out of currency. What about this person? Yes, we'll kick this person out because it's June 2015. And who in June of 2015 knows a goddamn thing about Alexander Hamilton.
Yeah. Was it Alexander who got pulled? I was going for Jackson, man.
Nope. Let's kick Alexander Hamilton off of the $10 bill, replace him with a woman, because it's not like suddenly by the end of the year people are going to have Hamilton mania. No way that could happen. Let's kick him out. So now a massive ton of people love Alexander Hamilton, and like me, they're coming to the realization that Alexander Hamilton's about to be kicked out of the 10. There is a movement. It's funny that you mentioned that, Bunny. There is a movement to get Alexander Hamilton to stay on the 10 and to kick Jackson out, because basically what they're doing is, out of all of the people on money, let's see which one of these people hated slavery. This guy, yeah, let's kick him off of money.
Yeah.
Because
I'm sorry, I am not a Hamilton fan. I'm sure the musical is good, but Hamilton was a dick. Okay, Hamilton is pretty much who set up the Federal Reserve, you know, and, you know, wanted to set up a national bank. Hamilton was the one who wanted George Washington to be king, you know? He was a dick.
Hamilton was, if you got all of the founding fathers and you said, okay, which one would be the most like Ric Flair?
Yes, okay.
Would be Alexander Hamilton. I imagine Hamilton walking into like some congressional, like a cabinet meeting debate, dressed in that Ric Flair sequined feathered outfit, just going, woo!
Yeah.
I am Alexander Hamilton. I am a limousine riding, jet flying, kiss stealing, named son of a gun.
Now, Jackson. What I would really like to see there is, let's get a new bill, okay? Let's get, I don't know, a thousand? I don't think we have a $1,000 bill. And put Jackson on that one. You know, one that a lot of people don't see. He was also kind of a shitty president. Indian massacres, he was really into that shit. He loved himself a good Indian massacre. But He was the biggest badass of a president till Teddy Roosevelt.
Yeah.
Okay. He had two assassination attempts on him. Back when it was one of those little musket one-shot guns.
Yeah.
So you had to get really close. Both times the gun failed to go off, and then he proceeded to beat the living shit out of his assassin.
And also,
that's worth a bill somewhere. Let's just kick him down the line a bit further.
I'd hate to say this, but I think that they should put a woman on the two, because a $2 bill is complicated.
Yes. Okay.
It's a complicated, confusing amount of money that is difficult to get and that no one understands. That makes sense.
Yeah.
Put a woman on that bill.
And especially if you whip out a $2 bill these days, and it was Jefferson on the $2 bill.
Yeah.
I don't know why Jefferson's not on currency. He's the real father of this country. But anyway, you whip one of those out now, and a lot of places won't even take it because they don't believe it's real money.
Yeah, they get confused.
Yeah. And they really, if you're a shopkeeper, you kind of need to know money.
Yeah.
Even if it's rarely used.
Yep.
You know, if I come in with a couple of Spanish doubloons, I can't use them here. I'm paying five times the price.
Yeah. They interviewed Lin-Manuel Miranda, the guy who wrote the Hamilton musical. They interviewed him on a talk show, and they asked him how he felt about the fact that they're going to be kicking Alexander Hamilton off the $10 bill. And just matter-of-factly, he said, yeah, I don't think that's going to happen.
Okay.
That basically, they were going to kick him out, but now that I've made this musical, yeah, pretty sure that's not happening. So, I don't know. I haven't heard anything about plans being turned around, but yeah. Alexander Hamilton is being removed from the $10 bill. Still, unless people like me can rally together. I love this musical. It's a wonderful musical.
Yeah.
I love it. I love this musical. It's amazing. I haven't been this obsessed with a musical in like ever.
Okay, so a quick couple of announcements. Let me just get these out of the way.
Yeah, go for it.
One, I am, and it's not going to take long for people to. I'm thinking of just discontinuing the YouTube version.
Yeah.
Altogether. Yeah, nobody watches it. Like, the only person I ever heard watching it was Jennifer, and I don't know if she's still watching it on YouTube either.
Yeah.
You know, and it takes a lot of time, and the big thing that the big reason for putting it on was, you know, we can monetize things on YouTube, but even if we were, like, a major hit or anything like that, YouTube pulls the copyright card out of its ass all the fucking time. We would never get paid for anything, even if we had 1 million views.
Yeah.
You know, so fuck them. You know, so, guys, you got about a week. If you're particularly attached to the YouTube version, let me know. But that's where I'm standing on that right now. So, you know, feedback, your thoughts. The second announcement is today I have decided to try an experiment. I put a message in the discussion group that we were going to be starting to record the show in about 10 minutes. This was a little while ago. and let people know that I was going to keep Facebook up. So if they wanted to chime in, I would, you know, if they wanted to, you know, go into chat or anything like that, I would read them on the air.
Okay.
So we'll see how that goes. And then the last thing is my friend Charlotte had posted this thing on Facebook that was really kind of interesting. Where is it? Because I can't, like, really. It was a list of serious things. It was really kind of a serious post. It was things like, almost there. I should have been prepared for this. Global warming is real. Trump is a shitty choice. Planned Parenthood should be funded. Guns should be legal, controlled to an extent, but not outlawed. Breastfeeding is natural. Having preferences in appearance of a partner isn't racist. Women should be able to choose or choose to abort or not. So you get the idea. It's a long list of things like that. To which I had posted, breastfeeding is natural unless it's me that's doing it. And then I added, I don't know why, I just went added, and I was like, if I get 1,000 likes on this, I'll post the video.
Nice.
So now there's a bit of a scramble. People are liking it, not tons. Charlotte doesn't have tons of friends, but if you run across it, like it, because now I kind of want to do it. I want to put out a sick-ass breastfeeding video.
I have tried to breastfeed Maxwell a bajillion times.
Yes.
Because Maxwell's tired, and he's like, Mommy, can I have some boob? He says, I'm tired. I want some boobie. And I'll immediately just lift my shirt up and say, okay, son, come here. Just come here. No, Daddy, not you, from Mommy. Are you sure? Mine tastes like popcorn and superheroes. I'll try and think of something to, like, say. Mine gives you superpowers. But no, he's not having it.
I'm just flashing forward about 30 years, and Maxwell is sitting in a bar after work, trying to unwind with a couple of friends and coworkers. Has a couple of drinks, which always loosens up your tongue, and just kind of like, did your dad ever try to breastfeed you?
You are welcome, therapists of the future. To all of America's future therapists, you are welcome.
And I do want to cover some current events, but please, go ahead. What else do you have there? You have a list.
I have a list because we're in January, and yet every time I go to any website on the internet, I'm still getting a face full of year-end lists.
Yes. Uh-huh.
I'm up to my ass in year-end lists. Every website, every blog, a year-end list of the best blanks of 2015. And I think that there's a certain classification of person that gets excited for the end of the year so that they can publish their favorite movies and favorite songs and all of this and that. And if you're one of those people, more power to you, but I just hate year-end lists. I just want to
know who died.
Yeah, well, that's what the Oscars are for.
Yes.
That's what the Oscars are for.
Have I mentioned this before? It's kind of too late for this year, but one year I want to coincide with the Oscars. I want us to do our version
of the Oscars.
Of the Oscars, but from all of the movies that we have reviewed in that year.
Ooh, that would be nice. That would be nice.
So, when they come out with the nominations, yeah. You know, for Best Actor, Best Movie, all that, we'll come out with our nominations.
Yeah.
For the movies that we've covered.
I like that. I would like to think that it would be less like the Oscars and more like the Cheapies.
The Cheapies.
From Cheap Seats is what I would like to think.
Yeah, but we do some things that have a budget sometimes.
We do. We do. We absolutely do. So I was going to make a year-end list of my favorite year-end lists.
Okay.
It would be a listception, but I decided not to go with that and went instead with a list that I'm very excited to break down. I went with my favorite paranoid ramblings of 2015. Yes. Now this is a special list, so I've got some special music for it. Hold on a second.
I hate punks worse than anything.
Oh, yes, I hate punks worse than anything. So anyway, these are my favorite paranoid ramblings of 2015. 2015 was a good year for paranoid ramblings.
Okay.
So I've got a list here of some of my favorite paranoid ramblings of 2015. And number one on my list, okay, which was actually something that people actually thought, Jade Helm 15.
Oh.
Never forget, always remember that the evil Dr. Doom Obama,
yes,
was taking over Texas, taking over the entire state, and using Walmarts, closed down, yes, Walmarts as secret FEMA concentration camps.
Yes, I remember.
And so much else. He was going to use like one of those electromagnetic pulses, like from Ocean's 11.
Yeah.
Or was it Ocean's 13? No,
I haven't
Ocean's
seen those.
13 was the earthquake. Ocean's, yeah, 11. That was the one. It was just going to knock out all electricity. And the reason why Jade Helm 15 didn't happen was because there were just too many gun-loving Americans,
uh-huh,
that were fighting for our freedoms.
Uh-huh.
So that's number one on my list. Number two on my list of favorite paranoid ramblings of 2015, Christians over-exaggerating about gay marriage.
Oh, Lord, yes.
Because they thought that just the world was going to end, that the United States was going to be destroyed, that there would be a massive flood that would destroy everything, and World Net Daily, the ultra crazy militant right-wing Christian website, actually said that Christians all over the United States were going to flee the United States and move to Canada or Russia because of the evils of gay marriage. I mean, Russia, because Vladimir Putin just likes to kill people.
Yes.
Canada, because it's close, but I don't think that any of those people realize that gay marriage has been legal in Canada for a very long time. The facts don't seem to enter into too much of these paranoid ramblings. And I am still upset that that one preacher didn't set himself on fire.
Oh, I was ready.
I had marshmallows.
And I was ready.
I was so ready for that guy to just Johnny Storm it up.
You could almost hear worldwide every Buddhist monk just say "pussy" in unison.
I'm thinking more like a "it's been done before."
Yeah, but that's my point. It's been done before. They actually did it.
Yeah. Number three on my list of favorite paranoid ramblings of 2015, blood moons. Not only that, blood but moons. The month of September.
I need to jump back just for a half a second more, though, on this about guy burning himself to death.
Oh, yeah.
And I remember it didn't happen, and everybody was kind of laughing at him. And then some people were kind of then coming back and like, you do realize that you're laughing about a man who didn't burn himself to death. And for a second, like for a half a second, I felt kind of bad. Like, oh, you know, yeah, that's kind of a, no, fuck him. Fuck him.
Yes.
Fuck him straight up the ass. He said he was going to burn himself. He's not burning himself. Chicken shit bastard does not live by his own convictions.
Yeah, and he was going to burn himself to death because gays were getting rights. That's not a good reason. Like, if you're going to burn yourself to death, at least have it be for a good cause. Burn yourself to death.
Because they're talking about coming out with Avatar 2. Okay,
Burn yourself to death to save Community or Firefly.
Yes.
Something like that. Not for freaking... I read the most amazing article. Speaking of Avatar, I read the most amazing article in Forbes magazine. Now, number one, the simple fact that I can say that with a straight face shows you that I'm getting closer and closer to my 40s. Nonetheless, I read an article in Forbes magazine, which was really great because it's the 5-year anniversary of Avatar coming out.
Yeah.
And it made... Now, one of the things that I didn't realize was that, yes, Star Wars beat Avatar, but Star Wars, the new Star Wars, episode VII... Four, five... VII, or is it VIII?
MCMX.
Okay. The new Star Wars beat Avatar's box office domestically, but worldwide, Avatar made a little under $3 billion. And the new Star Wars movie still has a long ass way to go to beat the worldwide box office of Avatar. It was a huge movie and a massive movie. And yet I've been talking to people and quizzing people. Nobody remembers a fucking thing from that movie. How could a movie break box office records worldwide and not stick in anyone's mind at all. I've been asking people, did Sigourney Weaver die in the movie or not? And most people answer me, wait, Sigourney Weaver was in that movie? And the thing is, I saw it three times.
Yeah.
Twice in the theater, and then once, like, on DVD, and I don't remember a goddamn thing. I couldn't tell you who any of the characters' names are. It was Giovanni Ribisi in that movie? Like, I think he was, like, the bad guy who was running the company trying to get the unobtainium, which is the worst fucking name ever. That's, like, just bad writing. That's just bad songwriting.
Okay, but unobtainium is a thing.
Yeah, it's hard to obtain.
But you don't have a planet of unobtainium, okay? You just don't. Unobtainium is like a widget, you know? It's like, you know, we could make something really cool. Like transporter technology, you know?
Yeah.
We could do this. We could do this. We could do this. If we had some unobtainium, then we could do this. And we can do this. It's like a stand-in for an element or a piece of technology that does not exist, has not been invented. But if you had it, then you can do these other things.
Yeah.
But don't put that in a fucking movie. It's stupid.
Yeah, you might as well have just called it a MacGuffin. Like, actually named it just MacGuffinium.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
It's just bad screenwriting.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just amazing that he's working on Avatar 2 and Avatar 3 and Avatar 4, but nobody remembers Avatar 1 because it was such a huge hit that didn't stick.
Mm-hmm.
Like, a few months after that movie came out, kids weren't playing with Avatar toys.
No.
And going nuts over the Avatar video game and saying, I can't wait for Avatar 2 and Avatar 3. And now he's saying, oh, no, I'm working on Avatar 2 right now. And it's just, like...
But give it credit where credit's due. A lot of furries and a lot of cosplayers like dressing up as the Avatar characters.
I was talking to Natasha about it yesterday, and I said, I remember that they had sex by connecting their ponytails. And they would, like, connect their ponytails to, like, the tails of animals and be one with the animals. But the only reason why I know that is because there was an Avatar-themed episode of Laser Cats on SNL one year. Their ongoing really bad sci-fi movie, Laser Cats.
Yeah.
And Natasha said, I remember a little bit, and she started talking about this guy and his twin brother and how one of the brothers died, so they got the other brother. And I'm like, wait, there were fucking twins in that movie? Like, I'm still not sure if she was right or not, or if she was just talking out of her ass, which is weird because I saw that movie, but nothing. Nothing. I retained nothing from that film.
I don't know, man. I've been kind of turned off of James Cameron for many years now.
No.
I
am not going to look up the plot for Avatar.
Don't accuse me of talking out of my ass then.
No, I didn't accuse you of that. What I said was, you could tell me any plot at all. You could say, oh yeah, I remember Avatar. Avatar was about these triplets and they were rowing champions and then they fought Mark Zuckerberg for Facebook. And I'd be like, okay, sure, whatever, because I don't fucking remember Avatar. I'm not saying you're talking out of your ass. I'm saying that if you were talking out of your ass, I would not know it at all, because that's how little I remember one of the biggest box office successes in the history of mankind. I think Giovanni Ribisi was in that movie, but I don't want to look it up on IMDb because it's about principles.
Fuck principles, I'm doing it.
Okay. I just don't remember any twin aspect. Is that why they got this guy and he was like, wasn't he a cripple? Wasn't he in like a wheelchair?
Yes.
I remember that. And I think Michelle Rodriguez was in it.
Yes.
And I think she died. So.
She's familiar.
Yeah, I think she died in it.
Who do you think was in it?
Michelle Rodriguez.
Giovanni Ribisi. He was like the bad guy in Ted. in the movie Ted, and to a lesser extent, Once Upon a Time in the West. I like that, but apparently I'm the only person in the world who liked that movie.
I haven't seen it, so I don't know. I know I refuse to watch The Ridiculous Six.
Oh, yeah. Once Upon a Time in the West is really good if you know your Westerns. It's a pretty good Western. It's essentially just a really good Western, but with people who are talking in a modern voice.
Yeah. It's going to be hard to beat either Blazing Saddles or Russell is Rhapsody.
Yeah. Fucking Avatar. So, the Blood Moons, and the Scimitar, and the month of September, uh-huh. A large amount of Christians thought that the world was ending this past September, because Blood Moons were happening, and the days coincided.
Jake Sully, a paraplegic former Marine, replaces his deceased twin brother as the operator of one of those bodies that they created. Huh? Told you. There was a twin in that bitch.
I believed you, but even if you were lying, I wouldn't have known. Because that's how little people remember Avatar.
Well, reading this, I was pretty spot on that I did remember.
Yeah, no, you were closer than...
But you are the exception and not the rule.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, I got it wrong. It was called the home tree.
The home tree?
Not the tree of life, the home
tree. I thought
tree.
It was the world tree.
Close enough, it was a tree.
Yeah, it was a tree. It was a big-ass tree.
And I was annoyed that they left out the county scratching post.
Yeah, there was a giant tree, but the thing is that I was waiting for the part where they show the rest of the planet, which I'm assuming had a big-ass silver ball. That area was called Epcot. And then there was an area with a big giant castle, and that was the Magic Kingdom. But no, they just focused on the tree. They just focused on... Disney World African Safari Adventure, whatever the hell it's called.
Giovanni Ribisi was in it.
He was in it? Mm-hmm. He was in it? Okay, I remember that. Was Michelle Rodriguez in it?
I guess we've been through this four times already.
Yes? Okay. I wasn't sure. I vaguely remember someone Mexican being in that movie.
You know what? Sigourney Weaver, she was an human with one of the bodies that was made for her.
Yeah.
So she probably did die because she wasn't. But I vaguely
remember her being in like the end ceremony thingamajigger at the end of the movie. You don't have to look it up.
I appreciate
that you are looking it up, but you don't have to. It's just a point that I'm proving that.
Oh wait, sorry. Tree of Souls.
The Tree of Souls?
Yes.
It's just stupid.
See, I told you. When they die, they, like, become a part of the tree. That's why it's called Tree of Souls. Ha! See?
Oh, boom. And that's how they become Groot.
That's right. Okay.
Gotcha. So.
And I just love that Avatar ushered in the new era of 3D, and 3D has pretty much died again.
Where'd it go?
Nobody gives a shit about 3D anymore. A lot of people are stuck with expensive 3D televisions.
Motherfuckers who have lazy eyes can't even see it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The Forbes article
it feels to me like 3D is like a generational leap year, you know? Because this is like the third time for 3D getting out of the box. And each year, each time it's like, oh no, it's different. And it seems to come around like every 25 years.
I remember the 80s, there was like a 3D resurgence. I remember going to see stupid movies just because they were 3D. I saw one of the Nightmare on Elm Streets the day it came out because there were scenes in 3D.
Yeah.
Like really stupid. What were you right about?
You remembered a lot.
You remembered a lot, but
Before she dies, they try to plead with the Tree of Souls to heal her. Sigourney Weaver's character, because she's a human with a connection to the what is it called? Navi body.
The rickety
Navi. And before the clan attempts to transfer her body,
Ku Klux Klan.
Transfer her from her human body into her avatar body with the aid of the Tree of Souls, but she dies before the process can be complete. And see?
That was a really good scene. I really liked it when the Tree of Souls was like, no. fuck you.
But eventually he gave in. It just didn't do it in time, I guess. But see, oops. And Jake
from State Farm?
No, the crippled Marine who took over.
His name was Jake.
His name was Jake.
Okay, yeah, no idea.
Jake the crippled Marine.
His name was crippled white guy.
Who took over his dead Marine brother's Navi body.
Okay.
He dies and is transferred in permanently into the Avatar body. See, I did remember a lot from the movie.
You did. You're the only person in America. I doubt James Cameron remembers this much.
I probably paid more attention to the plot than anybody who saw that film.
Because everybody was just going, ooh, this looks pretty.
Yes, it but was nobody a beautiful was paying movie, attention but to nobody this... gave a shit about anything else yeah. except for how beautiful it was.
Yeah.
I sat through most of the movie just being like, oh, what a piece of shit.
Well, you know, I saw the movie with one of my friends, and we went and saw it in IMAX 3D,
yeah.
And he had to leave the theater 20 minutes into it because he was going to throw up. Like, couldn't do it.
Who's the friend, honey?
I sat there by myself watching this movie. So
who's the friend you saw it with, honey?
Fuck you, Steve.
I hope they heard that.
We're all curious now.
The article on in Forbes magazine specifically said, and I liked this part, they said that Hollywood learned the wrong lesson from Avatar. They said that the lesson to Hollywood should have been, hey, look, this is an original concept. It's not based on a comic book or a movie or a TV show. It's an original idea. It has a very basic plot structure, and it has some really good special effects, and it's made a ton of money. And so an original idea can be a blockbuster and not just something based on something else.
Right.
What Hollywood learned was...
Fuck you. Fuck your original idea. We're going 3D, bitches.
Yeah. What Hollywood learned was 3D for everything now.
Mm-hmm.
If we make this movie 3D, we can get more money. Is all that they learned from Avatar, which is a darn shame, but I love me some Marvel movies, so
talk
I don't
shit again, I'm
don't necessarily.
Ass.
Okay, I won't be talking shit about you. So the next bit of
is
my
she out of the room,
yeah. The next part of my favorite paranoid ramblings of 2015 is. How horrible Natasha is. Shit, shit, shit. What?
I'll bust your ass.
Oh, she's going to bust my ass. And I need my ass for sitting and driving. Don't give me that look because they can't see the look on the podcast. It's a visual. It's an audio medium, honey. What? Don't hurt me. It'll be on...
Oh, please.
On video. On tape.
Yeah, act scared on audio video film.
Number four on my list of...
You got that shit wrong?
Yes, we already talked about that. I thought for sure that this was episode 59, but no, it's goddamn 60. Couldn't believe it. Could not believe it. Yeah.
You forget a lot of shit, but when it comes to stuff like this, you don't usually forget.
I think it was because we took the week off.
Probably.
It threw me off.
Yeah.
Threw me off.
Threw me off.
Threw everybody off.
I was sitting there like, wait a minute, no podcast this week? Christmas? What?
Yeah. Number four on my list is how everyone still thought that this was that last year was going to be the year that Obama was coming to take all the guns away.
Yes.
Obama's coming to take the guns. Another thing that really upsets me is how nowadays, if there is a massive shooting, there is a strong percentage of people who think it's fake.
We have had two in Colorado Springs just this past week.
Shootings?
Yeah, both up at the
Citadel. No, you haven't. They're false flags.
Yeah.
False flags. This is just Obama just lying. He's coming for our guns. I better buy 12 more.
Mm-hmm. That makes three in this town since the Planned Parenthood shooting.
Jesus. I'm sorry. I was just saying the reason for the shootings. Jesus.
Yeah. I'm telling you, the big blowout is going to be here someplace. a massacre of epic proportions, because we have a lot of conservatives and a lot of hippies. These groups do not mix.
Yeah, that's a weird mixture. And number five, the last on my list of my favorite paranoid ramblings of 2015, the selling of baby parts.
Yes.
And I gotta hand it to anti-abortion activists. They got pretty darn close in 2015. Because what they did is they looked at it from a new angle, is yep. what they did. They said, okay, so we can't ban abortions. What can we do? Let's get something that's absolutely legal and just change the wording of it. Mm-hmm. So now the donating of fetal tissue in order to create medicine.
Stem cells mostly, yeah.
To help people and to heal people and to heal the sick turns into they're selling dead baby body parts.
And stem cells, man, are so vital. I mean, this is breakthrough technology that's still in the experimental stage, you know, but it has such huge potential. You know, do you know much about stem cells?
Yes, I saw an episode of South Park about it.
Ah, okay.
You drink stem cells and you get superpowers.
So essentially a stem cell, because the fetus is so undeveloped, the stem cells are blank.
Yeah. Hold on. I'm going to stop you there. I want to apologize to everybody listening for my husband's ignorance on stem cell research.
Dude, I know a lot about stem cells. Cartman made a Shakey's pizza out of the stem cells.
No.
You can make pizza parlors out of dead baby body parts. That's what I learned. Trey Parker, Matt Stone.
See, I was prepared to make some joke about how much do you think we could get for the baby parts in my womb right now, but I can't do that now.
We are going to use
that. You were so Bunny, educate him. Tell him. I gotta walk away.
No, we
can
use
we get?
We can use the baby in your tummy to build a Shakey's pizza.
No.
That's what we can do.
I mean, whereas I would really like to see you have more children, but you know, this podcast needs funding somehow.
Exactly. Yep.
That's how it's happening. Boom.
How are we going to put on any type of campaign to bring awareness to the podcast without mm-hmm. money?
That's right.
And we will raise money by creating a Shakey's pizza.
No.
Yes.
It's just a sacrifice you're going to have to make.
Exactly. Yeah. We can always make more children.
Yeah. They're going to have to take it for the team.
At least for the next 5 years, I think I can make more kids. I'm just saying. I'm pretty sure I got 5 more years out of my belt.
Hey, Tina Fey had kids, and she's like 80.
Melissa Milano, she's 42, and she's got her baby's not even 2 yet, so she's got about 40.
Alyssa Milagro Beanfield War.
So anyway, stem cells are blank. So theoretically, and I think they've already had some success with it, I'm not sure. Theoretically, you can imprint on the stem cell whatever other kind of cell you want and then grow it, like grow a new heart out of it, you know, or replace your DNA or, you know, anything you could do with cells.
Yeah.
You know?
That was all spelled out in the South Park episode, so I want to defend myself here. I know a little bit about stem cells. I'm a big South Park fan. So that's
where the baby parts are going.
Okay. But they did a good job. People did freak out over the videos and the selling of the dead baby body parts, but basically that's kind of like saying that McDonald's is a company that supports the mutilation of innocent animals. Technically it's true,
right?
But just because you changed the wording of something doesn't make it illegal,
right? Uh-huh.
Bit ridiculous. This rubber band ball of mine
give them a little bit of break, cut them a little slack. Words are still kind of new for them.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So, like, all of a sudden now they just, there are other words? Okay, why don't we say this? So, you know, they're not good at it yet. They need practice. They need time to develop this new skill.
They do.
Yeah.
I agree with that. Like, one of the things that I did want... Yeah.
No, go ahead.
I was gonna change gears for a second and talk just a little bit about the situation in Oregon.
That is the current event that I really wanted to cover in particular. Yes.
Okay. I didn't want to talk too much about it because I don't fully understand it. Like, I don't understand why it's happening and why specifically, like, a wildlife preserve, like, that's an odd, out of all the federal buildings you could take over, it seems a bit odd. And I didn't realize why, what was, like, the impetus for, like, what's the cause? Why did they decide to do this? Apparently, there was a fire of some sort, two ranchers.
There are a couple of different things going on. First, there is the farmer, and I forget the rancher, and I forget what his name was. And
something
he,
Hammond. The yeah, Hammond family.
And he was the rancher who was keeping federal agents off of his land with a shotgun the other year.
Oh, yeah.
That
yes.
might have been like 2013, maybe? I forget. All the crazy is starting to run together. It really is.
Yeah.
So that was like the first part of it. But then the other part, and it was all about for him to be able to graze for free on federal land.
Yeah.
Where currently there is a, like, he just decided he didn't need to pay for this shit no more.
Yeah.
You know? And then some of the other ones from this Bundy militia. And I'm really disappointed in Al and Peg. I really am. I thought better of them. I mean, I always knew they were low class, but I didn't expect this. I have not seen Christina Applegate in any of the pictures, so I'm glad about that. But then these other ones were poaching on the same land,
okay?
Which right there, that's a crime. And then to cover up the poaching, they set it on fire.
Yeah.
And they burnt down at least a couple of hundred acres. Several firemen were killed.
According to American Family Radio, Sandy Rios in the morning, there was a fire that had broken out on its own, and all they did was set a fire around the perimeter of the actual fire in order to keep wildlife away from the fire that they didn't start. Because that's a thing that farmers do to protect the animals in their land.
Okay.
And you would know anything about that if you were a farmer who actually cared about America.
Yeah. Why the bird sanctuary? I have no idea. And why didn't they bring their own fucking snacks? I so want to see the Audubon Society kick their ass and have the Audubon Society bring the actual resolution to this situation. I want to see this so bad. I want to see that this situation would reach stupid to such epic proportions.
One of the things that
people
I like
will know about this thousands of years from now.
I got to hand it to these militiamen. I saw an interview with the head militiaman, and he talked exactly like the way that Christians talk that infuriates me.
Yeah.
Like the Talking Heads song Psycho Killer. You're talking a lot, but you're not saying anything.
Uh-huh.
And they asked him, they said, why are you doing this? What is the reason for this? And he just went off on one of those political speeches where I'm answering you and I'm making you happy and I'm also not saying a goddamn thing. The guy just went off and he said, well, we're doing this. We are doing this to protect the Constitution of these United States, which we love. We are patriots, and we are defending this Constitution from those people out there who seek to take away our freedoms, our God-given freedoms that were given to us by God and by the Constitution, and not by politicians who are trying to destroy America. It's like, you did not say a goddamn thing there.
Yeah.
That is the verbal equivalent of cotton candy. It's not food. If you get a cotton candy and put it in the shape of a steak and you eat it, it's not steak. There's no meat there. It's just cotton candy. That's all of what he said. Like, it was just, we're doing this because of the Constitution and 9/11 and flags and freedom and babies and God.
Mm-hmm.
God, freedom, guns, flags, America, freedom, freedom, Fox News, God.
And my pancreas.
Jesus.
Uh-huh.
It was amazing. It was amazing.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't understand. I don't understand the Oregon situation.
They literally posted their address for people to mail them snacks.
Yeah. Yeah.
What the fuck? This is it's epic. It is completely epic. I have never seen anything as butt fucking stupid in my whole 52 years.
During the Bundy Ranch,
Ford was not this fucking stupid.
During the original Bundy Ranch standoff, I remember being really nervous and thinking this could lead to something. I could see crazy people seeing this, if the government goes in there and starts firing like Waco, then this could be like a civil war situation that breaks out, because civil war is a big fear of mine. But when the Oregon situation happened, I just thought, okay, well, this one's just, they're being fucking stupid. They're being absolutely ridiculous. They were being ridiculous before, but I was nervous before. Now it's just, okay, well, let's just let these babies cry it out.
Yeah.
You know,
civil war does scare me a bit. Race war scares me a fuckload more.
Yeah.
Cuz us liberals will have to be the first to go. Where do we go? Do we go to an armed black encampment? Oh yeah, they're really going to believe that we're the good white people. You know, I mean, I wouldn't believe that horse shit. So do we have to go over to the redneck motherfuckers?
Well, it's all spelled out in the White Album. It's all spelled out. John Lennon, he knew. Mm-hmm. And that's why Sharon Tate had to die.
Yeah.
It's all there in black and white. Uh-huh. Clear as crystal. I am very excited about this week and this episode. Very, very excited about it. In fact, I've got some music set here. Yeah! I love this theme music. So much.
And I also want to know, if people actually send them snacks, are they going to really eat those snacks?
I read somewhere that some company sent them like organic beef jerky, like vegan beef jerky, like soy jerky.
Nice.
To them. Because
if I was going to send them snacks, in the least of it, I'm going to piss on the bags.
Yeah. I would put that Epicac stuff on everything.
Mm-hmm.
It would be, I would Halloween them. Uh-huh. Like, the snacks I send them, they would have to go to a mall in the 80s and have it x-rayed.
Yeah.
Like the day after Halloween in the 80s. That's how it would go down. They would have to get it checked for their safety. I imagine they would have to do that with everything.
Yeah.
Like, how desperate are they? Really interesting question. I want to get into the mind of these militiamen.
Well, it was day 3 they needed snacks. That's not long. I mean, that's...
That's a badly planned standoff. Yeah. You would think that they would be more prepared. Because prepping is an industry now. That's a major industry in America now. Preparing white people for Armageddon is a billion-dollar industry.
Yeah.
So you would think that these people would at least have some food and water there to hunker down.
Yeah. I had found it kind of funny. There was a meme that said, well, you said you wanted those guns for hunting. Go hunt some snacks.
Yeah, it is a wildlife preserve.
Yeah.
Go kill some pandas. Some liberal Oregon pandas.
Uh-huh.
Some Portlandia pandas. Mm-hmm. Before we get into this week's movie, really one of my favorite movies. I love this movie so much.
Okay.
Yeah, I think we should take a break. Should we take a break?
We should take a break.
We should take a break. We will be right back. Hold on. Hold on. No, I've got it. I know you're excited, Bella, to play the like commercial music, but I've got this music for the commercial.
You're mean.
How am I mean? I love this theme song. This theme song is.
Can you tell that to Maxwell?
No, I'm not going to tell it to Maxwell because he's spending some time with Nana. I'm not firing you kids. I was just playing some music. Some outro music. It's an awesome theme song. I love that freaking theme song. I have it on my phone. We will be right back with more of The Pope on Film after these commercial messages.
Outer Space International is a media collective and distribution network. We're bringing you unusual, experimental, and entertaining programs from many different creative worlds. We are thinking bigger than TV. We're channeling the great pioneers of UHF, home video, and early cable. We're also taking a bit of inspiration from the space race. Like it or not, we are the future. We want you to be nostalgic about the future again. Sneak previews, trailers, special announcements, the program guide, and random nonsense will run before and after scheduled content. Our content will be viewed in television households via Roku streaming devices, Chromecast, Amazon Fire, and a growing network of affiliates on various platforms, including cable and even broadcast. You should be able to watch on your smartphones as well. You can even watch on demand. Our goal at OSI 74 is to get this content to you wherever you're hiding. We encourage our producers to own and control their own content, as well as collaborating on new content for the channel to distribute. Series producers are also granted advertising spots in the schedule to promote their projects and monetize their work. We provide support and cross-promotion to our producers to build their audience and find smart people like you with a taste for the absurd. You can help boost the channel and the individual producers by purchasing items or programs, or by supporting fundraisers of your favorite shows, and even for OSI as a whole. This is a brand new venture, and we're making new discoveries every single day. Thank you for taking this journey with us. All systems go.
Oh, hello. I'm Dr. Eric Voronoff, and I'm going to read the list of this week's drawing entries. La La France, with two entries. Red Bird Western, with one entry. Bruce Nobles, with six entries. Jeff O'Brien, with one entry. Vince Rotolo with one entry. Eve Castillo with one entry. Kenneth Hendricks with one entry. Rose Mead with one entry. Gar Thaddeus Gernstein with one entry. Shirka Vratanen with one entry. Randall Grisham with one entry. Keith Hine with one entry. 9 Volt DC with 12 entries. More XP Gaming with 2 entries. Big Little Cast with 1 entry. Uh-Oh Monkey with 2 entries. Marion Munger with 1 entry. John Carl Mann with 1 entry. Amy Koch with 1 entry. Robert Marshall with 1 entry. Ralph Gordano with 1 entry. Good luck, you pack of losers. God, you make me all sick. Sick, sick, sick.
Back in our day, we rely on our minds, not search engines.
Okay, you want to talk about Bopon Film? Okay, okay. Facebook, you know, Bopon Film, and Twitter, of course, Bopon Film, at Bopon Film, or email us at hope@undeadtao.com. And really, if you're not sure how to listen, look, iTunes Store, just go there. Search Undead Cow. It's all one word, okay? Undead Cow. YouTube. It's the same shit I've been doing. YouTube.com. Of course, users. Undead Cow Films. Or find us on Stitcher. You know, if you can. I mean, is that still a thing?
And we are back with more of the Bopon Film. I am really excited to get to talking about this week's movie because I love this movie, but you know what I hate?
What do you hate?
I hate punks worse than anything.
Hate punks.
Worse than anything.
Worse than anything. Worse than wet socks. Worse than Pauly Shore.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Worse than anything.
Justin Bieber.
Yep.
I kind of hate Justin Bieber a lot.
Cats are okay. Cats are all right.
Then why do you
cats are douche waffles.
Yeah, cats are douche waffles, Bella. Cats are douche waffles. Hey, don't how dare you me, you.
I have a cat. He's a douche waffle.
Yeah. Cats are douche waffles. This week's movie is one of my favorites. I am talking about The Street Fighter.
Uh-huh.
This 1994 film has the sad distinction of being Raul Julia's final performance.
Yeah.
His over-the-top portrayal of M. Bison steals the show from Jean-Claude.
As he is destined to do.
As he is destined to do.
Uh-huh.
Raul Julia took that part because his kids told him that he had to. He was absolutely dying at that point in time.
So it's their fault.
Yeah. Absolutely their fault. Before we move on from yet another wonderful fake introduction, I would like to come to the defense of 1994's The Street Fighter.
Okay.
Universal Studios film. It cost $35 million to make. And it made a little under $100 million. So despite how people remember the film, it is shitty. It's a shitty movie. But it's a shitty movie that was a massive hit. So everybody can
like
suck.
Like Avatar.
Yeah, like Avatar. Uh-huh. Everybody hated the Street Fighter. And I hated the Street Fighter. But it was a fun hate. I liked hating that movie, The Street Fighter.
Yeah.
And then they made a video game based on the movie, based on the video game, which is the video game equivalent of Inception. Hairspray, the movie, based on Hairspray, the musical, based on the movie Hairspray. You saw like a miniature version. Specifically, you saw the play Hairspray Jr. But I think you would like the original movie Hairspray. Think you would like that, Bella. And what's it called? Crybaby. Think you would like that. Johnny Depp's in that.
I liked Crybaby.
Yeah, that was a cute one. So, okay. This week, we are doing another Kung Fu film. And for those of you just joining us, the reason for this week's film was because of Sonny Chiba's performance as Hitori Hanzo in Kill Bill last week, which was a good episode. If you haven't heard it, you should go check that out. We're on Stitcher and a bunch of other places. You know what I hate?
What?
Hate it when you're watching a TV show and it's interrupted. We interrupt this broadcast to bring you a special live bulletin. And they go live on the scene of some big thing that's happening. But they keep reminding you throughout the broadcast of what's happening in case someone just tuned. For those of you just tuning in, we are here live at the scene of blank. Now we're going to talk about what's happening for about 2 minutes. We're going to speculate. Oh, wait. Does that person have a gun? For those of you just joining us, we are here live at the scene of.
And they just keep. And that's the part that I really hate. It's something that's happening. It's breaking news, and the whole time you're watching it, nothing's happening.
Yeah. I remember, like, it was almost a drinking game when OJ got in the Ford Bronco, because literally, they kept reminding you over and over and over again. Mm-hmm. Bella, how long did you put those pizza pockets in?
What?
Huh? How long did you put those pizza pockets in?
5 minutes.
No, not 5 minutes. Are you kidding me? You're going to burn the house down. Get them out of there. They're pizza pockets. They're not goddamn turkeys. They're not steaks. Are they smoking? Are they on fire? Did you create the Tesseract?
No.
Okay. Got it. Like 30 seconds, and then you flip them over, and maybe like 45 seconds after that. You don't put them in for like 5 minutes and burn down our house, okay?
No. That's how you... That's what I want. It's my pizza pockets.
But it's my house that I don't want to be set on fire. Okay? Seriously, read the directions on those pizza pockets. Read the directions next time. The directions. Hi, Emerald. You okay, Emerald? What's up? You all right?
I went up and took that picture.
Went,
a rectangle.
You went.
And I have the thingies all over.
Okay. What does the sign say?
No, it's not. I just need a rectangle.
Oh, okay. That's confusing.
Okay.
So anyway.
Something has just come to mind, and I've got to let the world know about it.
Yes.
Because I very, very rarely have any kind of experiences on my job day in, day out, sucking my soul and destroying me. But this guy called today, and I was troubleshooting his wireless network, and his network name was Bill Y. the Science Fi. And I was like, okay, that was a bit of inventive.
That was. It's vaguely cute.
Whereas I have found that anybody who actually names their wireless FBI surveillance van,
ugh,
a lot of people actually do that. Complete douchebags.
Yeah. Yeah. Douchebags. Yeah. I agree with you on that. So, Sonny Chiba. Like in 1995 or 1996 or something like that, I had a Sonny Chiba box set. Bought it for like $20 and it came with like six Sonny Chiba movies. Yeah. Only one of them was the Street Fighter, though. All the other ones were different ones. I think The Bodyguard was in there.
Okay, and did you do the homework?
What was the homework?
Hitler's Children.
Oh, yes. No, I've seen that before. I've seen that a bajillion times before. I totally forgot that that was homework.
Yeah.
See, I thought it was episode 59. I forgot about the homework. Damn, I am just dropping the ball.
Yeah.
Hitler's Children. Damn, you have to remind me for this sort of crap. Specifically, it was based on a book called Education for Death.
Yeah.
The Making of a Nazi.
Mm-hmm.
And it's in public domain, which is odd because it's Disney. I imagine Disney just clutching everything with a death grip.
Yeah.
For existence. I read another article about copyright laws, that there are copyright laws that specifically say that after a certain period of time, things have to go into public domain. And there are people who, you know, every 10 or 20 or 30 years fight the government to change those laws. And those people are called Disney.
They're called Disney, yeah. Right now it's 90 years.
Yeah,
because it was previously 75.
Yeah,
but Mickey was about to turn 75.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah, technically Mickey Mouse and it should be in the public domain right now.
Mm-hmm.
So Walt Disney is continuing to fight the U.S. government to change our copyright laws, and there was the article interviewed some professor that said that this is the first generation that is not allowed to create things based on the works of the previous generation.
Right. And copyright law is just really fucked up. You cannot touch a video in almost any way. You know, yeah. the only way you can do it is you can kind of get away with parody. And you can kind of get away with fair use if you are trying to make some kind of a point. You know,
Yeah. You
can kind of get away with that. But like if you Google images, you know, which I do often, that's all fair game because I'm changing the original image. And it's also pretty much fair game in music if you're changing some part of the original tune or anything like that.
Yeah.
And Weird Al, of course, always gets away with parody.
Yeah, but he does always ask the actual author, the actual creator of the song, personally. He personally goes to that person and asks if it's okay.
I don't think he asked Coolio.
Coolio was the only time in which he asked the record company and not the actual artist. Record company said, oh yeah, we'll talk to Coolio about it, but we're pretty sure he'll be cool with it. And then the studio said, oh yeah, we talked to Coolio and he's fine with it. And then so he created it. He did the parody and then Coolio's like, what the hell? No one asked me about this. I would have said no.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So from that point on, he said, okay, well, then I am absolutely 100% going to each individual artist and asking them before ever doing this, and I'm never going to just ask the studio again. But mm-hmm. Technically, that's what he does now. It's interesting, the Hitler's Children cartoon, the propaganda short film, Who's He, What's It, the Disney cartoon, has a plot on Wikipedia that is actually longer than most of the plot synopsis for the movies that we watch for the podcast. This is a 10-minute cartoon, and the plot is longer than, like, the plot for Return of the Street Fighter. I find that to be absolutely fascinating. Absolutely fascinating. This is a creepy-ass cartoon.
Yes, it is. And what I find the creepiest about it, okay, what I really find the creepiest is that this is a cartoon about a child being indoctrinated into what? The Nazi lifestyle? Indoctrinated in hate and abject worship of Adolf Hitler. And it's adorable.
Yeah.
It's a Disney movie. It's fucking adorable. It's cute. And it's like almost cute on a really offensive level, you know?
Yeah. The animation is absolutely amazing.
I want to see a Disney cannibal film now.
Yeah, that would be nice.
Because that would be right in the same ballpark here.
Yeah. Like, Disney has teamed up with Eli Roth.
Uh-huh.
To bring you a new generation in animated musical horror movies.
Mm-hmm.
That's interesting. I would like that. I would watch that. I would wait in line for that.
Mm-hmm.
But this is an amazing... It's interesting to see the cartoon... And to see, it's impressive the quality of animation.
Yes.
This is like Sleeping Beauty quality animation.
Uh-huh.
The only other, like, World War II Disney cartoon of any note that I remember ever watching was Der Fuhrer's Face.
Uh-huh.
But that one's more of like a tongue-in-cheek, silly, stupid one. This one is mostly serious. There's only one little comical section.
Yeah.
Where Hitler's like a knight in armor.
Yes, but for the most part, it is very serious.
Very
rubs against that cuteness.
Yeah.
You know? So German couple, and they really walk you through a lot of the horrors of Nazi Germany, except don't mention the Jews.
Mm-hmm.
Don't mention the Jews. Like, not a mention of all the people they were killing. I mean, yeah. I would think that would have to be part of this.
Yeah.
But that's kind of the thing. I mean, you know... We in this country really weren't all that bothered about the Jews being killed.
Yeah.
You know? And we didn't want to enter this war. And there was a lot of political opposition to entering this war until Pearl Harbor got hit. Just like 9/11.
Yeah.
Now we got to go kick somebody's ass.
Yeah.
You know? But we see a newly married couple, and they have a baby, and they have to go register the baby, and there is a list of forbidden names that they're not allowed to name the baby, and they have to have all of their paperwork going back to their great-great-grandfathers, great-great-grandparents, or something like that.
Something like that.
To prove that they're pure Aryan. And therefore could have the baby.
And their passport has a bunch of spaces
yeah.
for, for like a crap ton of babies.
Mm-hmm. Because Hitler needs soldiers.
Yeah.
And then we see Little Hans, because that's what they wanted to name him. His name was not on the forbidden list.
Hans Gruber.
Yeah, we go through his sickness, but fuck that. That was kind of a minor point. They did put in some interesting things in there, though. But Little Hans goes to school and starts learning how to be a good little Nazi.
Yeah.
And how to declare their oath unto death to Hitler every morning. And poor Little Hans, the teacher tells them the story about a bunny and a fox and how the fox like kills the bunny and all that.
And he feels bad for the fox, and then he gets punished for that.
Well, he feels bad for the bunny and he gets punished for that, right?
Yeah.
And Little Hans is looking all sad and he's got to walk over to the stool in the corner and put the dunce cap on, and that's where I'm feeling like, don't worry, Hans. You'll become pure evil. You just have to try harder. You know, now I want to see, because I don't want to see Hans cry. You know?
Yeah.
So now I'm kind of rooting for him to be a good Nazi all of a sudden.
Yeah, just drink the Kool-Aid.
So I don't have to watch the poor kid cry, because he feels bad for a bunny.
Yeah.
And the other kids in the class, they start getting very, very hateful toward the bunny. You know, it was weak and it should die and, you know, Nazi rhetoric. Until they finally ask Hans again, and Hans goes all off on the stupid bunny.
Yeah.
And he hates the bunny with everything in him. Mm-hmm. And then Hans grows up. I'm sure there were some other things in there, but Hans grows up and he's a good little Nazi marching off to war. And they're...
Burning books.
Burning books, yeah. And they're showing how, like, he can't hear anything that's not the Nazi party. He can't see anything. He can't speak. And there's a chain around his neck with all the other soldiers. Interesting little piece of propaganda. And I do like myself some good propaganda videos.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's like anti-Nazi propaganda, so we can like it on that level. You know, we can't get upset that it's propaganda.
Yeah.
Because it favors our side, and that's a good thing. But God, it did have a really big creep factor.
Yes, absolutely. It's a creepy-ass cartoon.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's Disney's version of Nazis.
Yeah.
Like, how messed up is that?
Mm-hmm.
It's weird and creepy.
But it's a Disney cartoon for our times.
Yeah. And then it's basically insinuated that Hans dies.
Yeah.
Because Hans is just marching off to go with the other German Nazis to fight. And then all of them just fade into a picture of graves.
Yeah.
And that's his education. Mm-hmm. His education for death.
Uh-huh.
Da-da-da! If you haven't seen it, you really have to see it because it's freaking amazing.
It is something that everybody should watch. Yes.
Yeah. The animation is just absolutely beautiful. I remembered I used to watch this fairly regularly because my friend Michael Burns let me borrow a DVD, and I don't know if I ever gave it back to him, but it was the Walt Disney Treasures series. Yeah. And they were big box sets, and they were like $40, and they had all these really hard-to-find Disney cartoons. And there was a specific one, and it was Walt Disney Treasures on the Front Lines.
Yeah.
And it was just all of their all of the cartoons they did during wartime. And it was absolutely wonderful. So the kids and I used to watch a bunch of these propaganda cartoons all the damn time. Just all the damn time. Loved those freaking cartoons. Here you go. On the front lines, all the various cartoons that were themed to World War II. There were two. It also featured Victory Through Air Power in its entirety on there, which we did here on the podcast.
Mm-hmm.
On the podcast.
On the podcast.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Really cute. It had a bunch of other propaganda, not propaganda videos, but just instructional shorts.
Yeah.
So it had like, what is disease? The unseen enemy. And plans for good eating.
Tampon, saint or sinner.
Yeah, stuff like that. So that was homework. We should have done it in the beginning. We were too busy talking about Blood Moons and Avaturd.
Avaturd. Mm-hmm.
Goddamn Avaturd. I've got a video that I want to do for homework next week.
Okay.
It's a video that will either make you go, that's pretty cool, or it will frighten you to death for a million eternities. I am shooting it to you right now. It is on the Facebooks. It's a YouTube video. It's from 2008, and it's called Mass of Daddy Long Legs in a Tree.
Watch it.
I think I've seen that.
You probably have. It's a bunch of Daddy Long Legs found in a tree near Nogales, Arizona, which I've been to Nogales, Arizona, and it's just a desert wasteland, and it just looks like a bush. It just looks like a bush, but then you poke the bush and you realize that there's like 1,000 Daddy Long Legs in there, and it's creepy as hell. So I wanted a video that was kind of difficult to watch because I thought it would go well with Education for Death.
Daddy, do you still have your fish on your blog?
What, Bella? Yes, I do still have the stupid fish on the fish? Blog. No, you are not feeding my fish right now because I'm trying to do the podcast.
But why?
Because I'm not going to, like, step aside recording my podcast so you can feed fake fish on my blog.
Well, fish are awesome.
The fish are awesome, but you're not feeding my fish right now. And it's funny because on my blog, I literally named it. Let me see. I still have them here somewhere. What are they called? I named the fish something along the lines of the darn fish thing my youngest daughter loves. Nope, stop it. You're not feeding them right now. You are not. N-O-T, not feeding my fish right now, okay? So next week, Daddy Long Legs. It's only like a minute long video, but it's messed up.
And it is posted in the group.
Sweet. So let's get to talking about Sonny Chiba.
Sonny Chiba Street Fighter.
His real name is Sadaho Maeda. He was born on January 23rd, 1939, so it's almost like Chibamas, which would be Chibamas. The Sonny Chiba Christmas.
Yeah.
Like Woodmas. It's almost Chibamas, so happy Chibamas to all of you that are listening to the podcast.
The 26th, you said?
No, the 23rd. 23rd.
Okay, Jeannie's is the 25th.
Oh, okay. So she's born on near Chibamas. So yes. That's good. Uh-huh. That's good. He was born in, I believe, in the city of Chiba, and then he got his first name is a nickname because he did a series of commercials for like the Sunny S series of automobiles in Japan.
Yeah.
So they just called him Sonny Chiba. In 1965, he earned a first degree black belt, which I believe grants you +5 dexterity and also shortens healing times in between campaigns. So that's good. You're going to want to put that in your inventory.
Mm-hmm.
His first starring role was in the 1961 shitfest Invasion of the Neptune Men. Featured on Mystery Science Theater 3000, he plays Space Chief. Thank goodness he moved away from Invasion of the Neptune Men type movies, because that movie is crap. Wikipedia calls Sonny Chiba one of the first actors to achieve stardom through skills in martial arts.
Mm-hmm.
It,
watching this movie, I could really see why he in particular kind of took over the throne from Bruce Lee.
The way I always looked at it was that he was the anti-Bruce Lee.
Exactly.
Like a yin and a yang, a light side and a dark side.
He was very much the anti-hero.
Yeah.
Where Bruce Lee was always the hero, almost holy man.
Yeah.
And Sonny Chiba in this movie, really pretty much of just a fuck.
Bruce Lee was the Jedi and Sonny Chiba was the Sith. In wrestling terms, Bruce Lee was the face. Mm-hmm. And Sonny Chiba was the heel.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Yeah.
And like, that makes sense to me because it never works out when you try to replace somebody as big as Bruce Lee.
Yeah.
With somebody just like Bruce Lee.
Yeah.
You know, that never works out. That never works on TV shows when they have to replace a character or anything like that. It's always somebody who has, it has to be somebody who is new and fresh and something you haven't seen before. And Sonny Chiba really fit that bill, just like Jackie Chan was kind of the polar opposite of Sonny Chiba.
Yeah.
Now, we've never pretended to be martial arts experts or anything like that, so there may have been somebody else in between Sonny Chiba and Jackie Chan, you know, so sorry if we don't know that, but
yeah,
you get the point.
Yeah. So this is some IMDb Sonny Chiba, because he's been in just a whopping shit ton of movies. He was in Battle Royale 2.
Yeah.
Another tie there to the podcast. He was in the 1977 Golgo 13 movie Assignment Kowloon.
Okay.
Golgo 13 was a series of, I believe, mangas, and then they were turned into animes, and there was a video game I remember playing on like the original NES system. Anyway, that's a big deal over there. Uh-huh. He was also in Iron Eagle 3.
Okay.
He was the also
Top
in an
Gun ripoff series of movies.
Yep. He was also in, and I did not know this because I haven't seen any of these goddamn movies. He was in one of the Fast and the Furious movies.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah, he was in the Tokyo Drifting. Yeah, he was in the Tokyo Drift. And he was also in, and I did not do the playlist like I said I was going to, but I'm going to do it after this, after we record this. So by the time this airs, it should be up there if you want to see it. He was in the 1994 film Immortal Kombat with Rowdy Roddy freaking Piper. May he rest in peace. I drop my beverage on the floor from my dead homie there.
I do want to see that. I can't get enough of Rowdy Roddy Piper. I really can't. And I haven't seen too terribly much that he's actually been in.
Well, They Live is amazing.
Oh, God, yeah.
They Live
Hell
is...
Hell Comes to Frogtown, baby.
Hell Comes to goddamn Frogtown. And he was in a specific episode of It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia.
Yeah.
Where the gang decides to do a wrestling show for the troops. They just decide they need to do something for the troops. So they do a wrestling show and they find some washed up wrestler and it's Rowdy Roddy Piper. I think his name is like the Killer or something like that.
Okay.
But he's wonderful in that. Immortal Kombat specifically, that's one of those movies that in like 1998 or 1999 you would see it at like 1 a.m. on TBS Superstation.
Hell Comes to Frog Town? Yeah.
No, Immortal Kombat.
Oh, Immortal Kombat?
Hell Comes to Frog Town as well, but Immortal Kombat was one of those films where you probably changed past it while it was playing on USA at 8 a.m. on a Sunday. Uh-huh. Or like at 2 a.m. on WGN.
Yeah.
It's one of those bizarre... It's a weird movie because it's just a very standard and fairly bland by-the-books, by-the-numbers buddy cop film. The only odd part about it is that the buddies are two fairly archaic pop culture artifacts, because Rowdy Roddy Piper was like... He was in between WWF and WCW at the time, so he wasn't really doing jack shit. And Sonny Chiba was not the Sonny Chiba yet, because Quentin Tarantino wasn't a big deal. So I like the idea of like this washed up wrestler who's waiting for his next big break, and a fairly archaic character actor. So I have a list of movies.
Okay.
That we could make.
Okay.
Following this same basic structure. So I'm going to pitch these at you. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Here's the first one. Joe Pantoliano.
Uh-huh.
The character actor. He was the guy who... yeah, Joey Pants. From The Matrix.
He was the shit in The Matrix. He's been in a million fucking things.
Million things.
He was the reporter in the first Ben Affleck Daredevil movie.
Yes. Yes.
God, he was on The Sopranos for a while.
Yeah. You team him up with WWF's Lance Storm.
The name sounds familiar. I don't know who he is.
He's a Canadian wrestler, and his gimmick was that he had no personality at all.
Okay.
His whole thing was just that he was boring and bland, and he could barely talk on the mic. He was just really boring. That was his gimmick, was that he was boring. So we call it New York meets Canada.
Okay. Because
Joey Pants will be like, hey, we need to go and fight these guys. And hey. And Lance Storm is like, yes, but first we should put air in our tires. Because that will help us save on gas.
Mm.
And it's also the right thing to do. New York meets Canada. That's the first movie.
Okay. So
the second one. The second one is a bit of a stretch because the actor that I got is a bit big, but I think he'd be good. So okay. You get Forrest Whitaker.
Yeah.
You team him up with Harley Race. I specifically looked for archaic professional wrestlers, and here's the hard part, that are still alive. So wrestlers are dropping like flies, but Harley Race is still around. So this one I call Lazy Eye and Curly Hair.
Okay.
Because Harley Race had this weird redhead Jew fro, but he wasn't Jewish. He just had this like redhead fro. And then guy in curly hair. That's what we call that one. That's okay. My second movie. Okay. Here's my third one. This one I'm really proud of. You get Joe Don Baker.
Uh-huh.
Who is somehow still alive.
God knows how.
You team him up with WWF manager Mr. Fuji.
Mr. Fuji, okay.
I'm calling it Mitchell 2. Mitchell Goes Oriental. A direct sequel to Mitchell. Uh-huh. There's a crime that happens in the Orient. We don't specify where. We just call it, quote, the Orient, unquote. And the only person who can save the day is Mitchell, but he's still he's all washed up. He's fat and he's slow and he's drunk. The thing is, though, is that he hasn't gotten that way. He's always been that way.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, Mitchell, you're washed up. Oh, wait a second. You were always washed up, weren't you? There's no difference between Mitchell 1 and Mitchell 2. It's like, oh, man, you're a drunk. Oh, no, wait, you've always been a drunk. I guess you're still a drunk?
In that case, you look pretty good.
Yeah, in that case, you look great. So my last pitch for you, this is my best one. I'm really proud of it. This is going to work. This is going to work.
All right.
Blow up the box office. Clint Howard and Coco Beware.
Okay.
I'm calling it Good Cop, Bird Cop. Because Coco Beware always had Frankie, his parrot. So Clint Howard is like the good cop, but the bad cop is the bird.
Uh-huh.
Bad cop just keeps fucking everybody up with his talons and shit. Attacking people.
Nice.
Good cop, bird cop. Boom. This is going to beat Avatar's world box office grosses. That movie's going to be huge. Good Cop, Bird Cop.
We might have to start working on the script for that one.
Yeah. Yeah, that's going to be a huge one. I keep clicking all these videos. Oh, my God, that's gross. Oh, why did I click that video? Oh!
Still the spiders?
No, this one's called Deadly Spider Bites. Oh my God, it's like something Eli Roth masturbates to. It's really just, oh my God, this is the worst in the world. Like, it's so bad I'm covering up the screen. Oh no, stop showing it. Ah, this is even worse. Ah.
Is it about spiders?
Yes.
Can I go over and watch it?
No, you can't watch it. This is horrible.
What is it?
Oh my God, no. I clicked it. No, you are not watching the spider. It was just a video of just a look at some of the worst spider bites in history. And oh my God, that was horrible. That was horrible. Why do I keep clicking these stupid videos? Why do I click on stuff when I know that I'm going to be freaked out by it?
They are going
somehow,
to hurt
somehow
you.
This is your fault, Bella. I'm going to make this your fault. No. You know why this is your fault?
Because you hate punks worse than anything.
Because you're a punk. And you know how I feel about that, Bella?
Worse than anything? Like, you don't like
punks? I hate punks worse than anything.
Worse than anything. Worse than terrorism. Worse than Al-Qaeda. Worse than that movie that John Travolta did where he was an angel. Michael. Was that it? Michael? I think he was just called Michael. Yeah. Weird. Here's another interesting fact about Mr. Sonny Chiba. Uh-huh. You might know. Interesting fact. He's fucking awesome.
Yes, he is.
Interesting fact there. Interesting fact. Now, full disclosure, I would be remiss if I did not mention this. I only know Sonny Chiba from Mr. T, Quentin Tarantino. Now, I'm not talking about Kill Bill.
Uh-huh.
I'm talking about True Romance.
I have yet to see True Romance.
I know you have yet to see True Romance, but in the beginning of the movie, it opens up on what's his name, the star of it, Christian Slater's character. And he's at a bar talking to some skeezy drunk woman. She was like the drug-addled mom in The Crow.
Oh, okay.
She was in The Crow, and she was in True Romance, and I've never seen her in anything else. But he is obviously at this bar trying to hit on this woman, and he's got like a monologue that he's obviously gone through a number of times, basically talking about how he loves Elvis so much that he would fuck Elvis.
All
right. Like, he's not gay, but if he would have gay sex with any man, it would be Elvis. So he's talking to this
That's
woman.
That's an interesting approach to picking up women.
Yeah.
Hey, you're really hot. Do you want to hear about the guys I'd fuck?
Yeah, and then he invites her to go with him to this Sonny Chiba triple feature that's playing at the local theater. And she's just kind of like put off by this. You want to take me to a kung fu movie? And he's like, I want want to take you to three kung fu movies. Street Fighter, Return of the Street Fighter, and Sister Street Fighter. Mm-hmm. And she's like, I don't think so, not my taste. So she leaves and he goes alone. And then opening credits. That's the opening credits to the movie. And when the movie comes back, he's sitting there in the theater and you watch a good portion of the movie, of the opening. And then another woman comes in, a completely different woman, Patricia Arquette's character, and they start hitting it up. And she's like, why don't you fill me in? What do I miss? And he starts talking about, okay, that guy right there, that's Sonny Chiba. Now he's a badass. And he's basically just fucking with people. And it's from that point on, I made it my mission to just, okay, they focus a lot in the beginning on Sonny Chiba and the Street Fighter.
Yeah.
It's the opening of the movie. It's the opening of the movie. I did not know Sonny Chiba or Street Fighter until I saw True Romance. I love the movie True Romance. So I wanted to talk about True Romance for a little bit.
Okay, great. I've really been wanting to see this movie, and I just haven't. I understand that you get sections in that movie of Mr. White in Alabama.
Yes. The script was written by Mr. T, Quentin Tarantino. He originally wanted to direct it, but he passed. The movie came out after Reservoir Dogs, and it did good for him. He didn't direct it. Mr. Top Gun did. Tony Scott directed it.
Yeah.
Mr. 1980s, 1990s action movie guy. He did Days of Thunder and Last Boy Scout and Crimson Tide and all of these very 80s, 90s movies. The dialogue is very Tarantinian.
Yeah.
Because he basically Tony Scott didn't mess with the script at all. It also has a lot of actors who went on to be Tarantino regulars. Christopher Walken's in it and Samuel Jackson's in it. And Brad Pitt's in it. And, of course, the number one Quentin Tarantino regular, who's been in pretty much every film, I'm talking about Bronson Pinchot from Perfect Strangers.
Uh-huh.
Balky.
Uh-huh.
Who's basically starting every...
His true badassness has yet to come out.
Yeah.
But it's coming. You mark my words.
I love True Romance because I see True Romance in a lot of the same way that I see Sonny Chiba, in that Quentin Tarantino sold two scripts to Hollywood, True Romance and Natural Born Killers. Those are the yin and the yang. I see those films in much the same way as Sonny Chiba and Bruce Lee. Because there's a right way and a wrong way to do a Quentin Tarantino movie.
Mm-hmm.
Because when Natural Born Killers, Oliver Stone got the script and rewrote it so much that Tarantino eventually received a story by credit. And that's it.
Yeah.
Because Oliver Stone said, who are you, Quentin Tarantino? Don't care. I'm going to change this, rewrite this. I'm going to let Rodney Dangerfield write this whole scene. I'm going to rewrite this entire thing solely because of a guy who will eventually portray Iron Man. I'm going to take this out and this out. I'm going to put this in. Whereas in True Romance, Tony Scott said, okay, this script is brilliant. I'm not going to change a thing except for one thing. The original ending to True Romance was a goddamn bloodbath where everybody dies. Tony Scott changed it so that some people get out in the end. But beyond that, he kept the script, and I like that. So True Romance is the good non-Quentin Tarantino Quentin Tarantino movie. Natural Born Killers is the bad Quentin Tarantino non-Quentin Tarantino movie. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I do. I still kind of like Natural Born Killers. I'm not in love with it. It really feels like it's missing something.
It's got a great soundtrack.
Yeah.
I'll give it that. And I want to talk about Will Smith.
Okay.
Because Will Smith was offered Django in Django Unchained. But apparently Will Smith has in all of the contracts that he signs for movies a specific part in the contract which says that him and his team, his entourage, reserve the right to rewrite the script of any movie he's in so that the film retains Will Smith's voice. So basically, Quentin Tarantino's like, hey, I want you to star in this movie. And he's like, great, I will if you let me rewrite all of your script, Mr. Tarantino.
Uh-huh.
And Mr. Tarantino said, yeah, I don't think I need you that bad.
Mm-hmm. And I don't even understand that. So, like that's an admission that, you know what? You can't act. You cannot act. All you could do is your own shtick, and that's it. You can't stretch as a performer or anything else because it's got to have Will Smith's voice.
Yeah, I want to see the Will Smith version of Django Unchained where he's being taught on how to be a killer, and he's doing his Will Smith thing, like,
right?
That's my Will Smith impersonation.
And I've never liked, it was Jamie Foxx, right?
Yeah, it was Jamie Foxx.
I've never been a fan of his.
Jamie Foxx has a small cameo as Django in the goddamn Once Upon a Time in the West.
Oh, nice. Nice. But he says, blew the fucking doors off of that character.
Oh, yeah. He was wonderful in that. I also love the fact, the one part of Django Unchained that I love the most is the fact that he kills an entire cabin filled with actors from the movie Jesus Christ Superstar.
Were they?
Yeah. Jesus and Judas are in Django Unchained.
Like the original movie with Ted Neely and...
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, fuck.
They're both in that. I think Jesus is in a bath, and then Judas is just sitting there in a cabin, and he just kills all of them. It's that part where he's, like, his best friend mentor's been killed, and he's being tortured, and he's been sent off, and then he, like, breaks free and kills everybody, and that's when he starts on his path of vengeance.
Oh, wow. Cool.
Yeah. It's very like cool. The time they don't say, I don't think they even say any words of dialogue, but it's totally them. If you look at the credits, Quentin Tarantino had Django Unchained shoot Jesus and Judas, and it's awesome.
I love Jesus Christ Superstar. I'm going to have to watch that now. I'm going to have to watch that scene again. And I finally found True Romance on Amazon Prime, so I'm going to be watching that later.
Cool. I'm gonna skip a little bit. I was gonna save this for when we're actually talking about the plot and all that sort of stuff. Okay. But one of my favorite lines in the movie The Street Fighter is a line that you can't find in most copies of the movie.
Okay.
Because this movie is in public domain, but the version that is in public domain that you see on YouTube and archive.org and most of the websites out there is a really shitty quality of the movie. And there's a specific part.
That's what I saw.
Yeah. There's a specific part in the beginning where it skips and you miss one of my favorite lines of all time. That's what I like about True Romance, is True Romance shows a really good version of that opening, and you get the actual line. In the crappy version, Junjo is like, I would like to fight you so that I might kill you and take the breath from your lungs and rip your heart out and do all of this shit. If only we had the time. And Sonny Chiba's character, he says, my heart beats and there's time. That's the line, my heart beats and there's time. And then they go into the fight. But in the crappy version, which is spread all over the internet, there's a skip. So what he says, what he actually says in the version that everybody sees now is, my heart at time.
Mm-hmm.
That's what he says, my heart at time.
Yeah, I actually wound up watching a subtitled version.
Yeah.
So I had a very hard time getting into this movie. I have some things that I liked and disliked and all that, but it took three viewings, man. I kept losing the thread of what the fuck was going on.
That's funny because I started watching the subtitled version, yeah, and then I'm like, nope, I need the bad voice acting. I need that.
Yeah.
I absolutely need that. I need to hear those really bad voices. But I love the line, "My heart beats and there's time."
Yes.
Like, I've used that before. Like, my wife is like, "Hey, do we have time for a quickie?"
Oh, no.
"My heart beats and there's time." "You think there's time for, like, maybe, do we have time for maybe one more drink?" "My heart beats and there's time." That's a great line. Unfortunately, the only real way nowadays that you could hear that full line is by watching Christian Slater's character watching the beginning of True Romance. It's sad.
Yeah.
But before we get into the meat of it, I've got a list of some of my favorite lines. I've got some stats and an insanely detailed plot. I wrote so much about the plot that it's like a serial killer's manifesto. Do you see this?
Okay.
Do you see this? Like, how do I write so small when I have bad eyesight? It's weird. Anyway, before we get into all of that, I think that we should take a break. Should we take a break?
I think we should take a break.
I think we should take a break. We will be right back with more of The Pope on Film after these commercial messages.
Hey, everybody. It's me, Dabney, the fucking alien. And I'm here to update you on this week's leaderboard. At number 10, Uh-Oh Monkey, with 7 entries. Number 9, Evgeny Moldyk, with 6 entries. At number 8, Dylan Connolly, with 7 entries. At number 7, C.G. Hackett, with 9 entries. At number 6, Eric Ballou, with 11 entries. At number 5, Manic Mommy 7, with 12 entries. At number 4, Brock Z. Davey, with 19 entries. At number 3, Julie Davey, with 29 entries. At number 2, Bruce Nobles, with 150 entries. And number 1, holding fast to that lead, 9-volt DC, with 457 entries. Good luck, everybody, and congratulations. Thanks for liking and sharing and supporting The Pope on Film.
Do you like comic books?
Me too!
Do you listen to podcasts?
Are you still talking to me?
Cool! I have one called The Comic Book Update.
So?
I do weekly reviews of story arcs, comic miniseries, ongoing titles, and more!
I don't care.
I know, right? So all you have to do is go to the website at comicbookupdate.com.
Why would I do that?
We post daily previews of new comic books every day.
Ugh, someone save me.
And every weekend is Cosplay Sunday, with blog posts featuring cosplayers from around the world.
Excuse me, miss, is this guy bothering you?
Back off, buddy. She's with me.
Yeah, I don't think so.
Sorry. Nerd rage.
Oh, yeah.
So check out The Comic Book Update at comicbookupdate.com, as well as on iTunes, and stream it live on Stitcher. The Comic Book Update, the antidote for nerd rage.
And we are back. with more of the Pope on Film. I'm excited to talk about this movie because if you've got to fight, fight dirty.
See, I'm going to be missing all these good lines now because I bet you none of them were subtitled or they didn't come off as cool.
That's the tagline that was on the poster and in the U.S. Preview, the trailer.
Yeah.
So that one wasn't in the movie. But I've got a list of my favorite lines, so I'm not sure how many of these are going to be in your version. But
okay.
Street Fighter stats. 1974 Kung Fu movie. In Japan, the title translates to Clash Killer Fist. Not 100% sure what that means, other than he has a fist, which is quite a killer. It was directed by a guy named Shigehiro Ozawa, and he actually directed the entire series. So he directed Street Fighter, The Return of the Street Fighter, Street Fighter's Last Revenge, and Sister Street Fighter. One of the things that I did not realize is that I knew about Sister Street Fighter.
Uh-huh.
I did not realize that that was spun into its own series.
Sister Street Fighter was one of those that I had the trailer for it, and I used to use it for graphic testing.
Yeah.
You know, like if I needed, you know, like if I was, I don't know, building my own television in 3D space or something, what I would put on the screen would be something like Sister Street Fighter or Bloody Pit of Death.
Bloody Pit of Death. Yeah.
Or Bloody Pit of Horror. You know the one I mean.
Yeah. Yeah, the one with Mickey Hargate on it.
Exactly.
Yeah. So they actually did Sister Street Fighter, Sister Street Fighter Hanging by a Thread, then The Return of the Sister Street Fighter, and then the final one, Sister Street Fighter Fifth Level Fist.
All right.
So they actually made a crap ton of those Sister Street Fighter films, which was surprising to me because I believe I've seen Sister Street Fighter once, but other than that, I've never seen the damn movie. I don't love it.
Yeah.
Anyway, the movie was also produced by the Toei Company. Toei? T-O-E-I. They've been around since the 50s. They did the Kamen Rider series of TV shows and movies and some Sailor Moon movies. And they also did Battle Royale.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
So that's good. That's a good tie. If you would like to learn more about Battle Royale, you should listen to our Battle Royale episode of our podcast.
Mm-hmm.
Of our podcast.
One of the best episodes ever.
That was a damn good podcast. It was Street Fighter was the first film to be rated X in America solely for violence.
Really?
Yeah. Specifically, a few gory scenes like the X-ray brain punch that happens near the end, where Sonny Chiba hits a guy in the head so hard that you see an X-ray of his skull caving in.
That was, oh my God, that was such a weird fucking choice.
Yeah, yeah.
I was like, what the fuck?
And the castration scene. There's also the castration scene where a girl's getting raped and he decides to act upon that. What other gory scenes? There's also the ripping out of the voice box at the end.
Uh-huh.
And all of these gory scenes, there's a few more. There's one scene where he hits a thug so hard that he just starts spitting out teeth like crazy.
Yes, that was a good one.
Teeth and blood. And all of these scenes are just covered in that grindhousean sort of bright red paint for blood sort of.
Uh-huh.
That bright red blood that they use in those grindhouse films where it's like, we're not going to pretend this is real blood. Let's get the most neon fucking paint imaginable for blood. You know what it reminded me of?
What did it remind you of?
Have you ever had an Egyptian feast. So, some of my favorite lines in this movie. Number one is the skip, which you have to watch either like a really good version of it or watch it in True Romance. My heart beats and there's time. I love that line. The other line happens right after that because he Sonny Chiba's fighting Junjo and he puts him in the oxygen coma, which is an ancient technique.
Right.
And Junjo says something along the lines of, an oxygen coma. So that means you're a Diagu school member.
Yes.
Or something along those lines. But the line, which I absolutely love, Sonny Chiba says, "I owe nothing to any school." And I love that goddamn line because, like Sonny Chiba, I also owe nothing to any school.
Mm-hmm.
"I owe nothing to any school." I love that. That's an awesome line. That is an awesome, badass line. The other line that I like, which happens when the Yakuza sends everyone to go and to try and kill him, he says, "I love just the dichotomy of this line, how mean and nice it is, all in one sentence." Absolutely love this line. He says to some random thug, "Tell that bitch who sent you how sorry I am. I can no longer be her friend." I love that line because it's just so mean in the beginning.
I don't remember any of these lines.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't think they were there at all.
Yeah. "Tell that bitch who sent you how sorry I am. I can no longer be her friend." Oh, it's like at first you were being really mean, but now you're being kind of nice.
Yeah.
Being kind of nice. And then, of course, one of the greatest lines in the history of cinema.
"I hate punks worse than anything."
Ah, me too, Mr. Chiba. I also hate punks worse than anything.
Mm-hmm.
Worse than anything. So let's talk about the plot of this movie.
Okay. If we can. So it's... let me try telling you what I seem to have gotten out of this. Because it may be drastically different.
Yes.
So there is a karate master from Okinawa.
Named Junjo.
Okay, his name in the thing was something with an S.
Yeah, yeah, no, it's different in the American version and in the Japanese version. But yeah, in my American version, in my Patriot Freedom version, his name is Junjo.
Okay. So he was in jail for whatever. I'm not sure what exactly he was in jail for.
I know what he's in jail for. He's a karate master having fights with people, but he's been fighting to the death.
Yeah.
So he's killed like 7 people in death matches and he's being executed.
Okay. So, yes, he's being executed and Sonny Chiba kind of comes and like rescues him.
He pretends to be like a priest.
Yeah.
A
Buddhist
priest. But he's really Terry Suguri. An ultraviolet half-breed mercenary son of a bitch.
Yes. And so in this rescue operation, the first guy decides he needs to beat up Sonny Chiba, who's trying to rescue him. Okay.
The real weird part is, hey, you're about to be executed in literally about 45 seconds.
Right. Uh-huh.
45 seconds from now, you will hang to your death. But someone's come to visit you literally at the exact last second. So here, we'll give you about 35 seconds to hang out with this person. And then we really do have to kill you. Like, literally, Sonny Chiba shows up literally about a minute before he's to be executed. Mm-hmm. Like, really, the timing is amazing.
So now they fight. And is that where Sonny Chiba says the heart line?
Yeah.
Okay, I kind of thought so.
My heart beats and there's time.
So then he does the oxygen thing.
The oxygen coma. It's an ancient technique.
Yes. And the first guy passes out. And Sonny Chiba leaves.
Yeah. He passes out right before the execution. And apparently, to kill someone, they need to be in perfect health.
Wasn't that incredible? He was too hurt to execute.
Yeah.
I was like, what the fuck? He's almost dead.
We can't kill him now.
Yeah.
Like, if you really wanted to kill him, you probably just, like, a kick to the chest.
Yeah. Like, I don't know. I think I would have been like, okay, look, what we really need to do in this situation is we need to go back to my office, all of us, and talk it over for about the next hour or so to make sure we're coming to the right decision. And by the time you get back, he's fucking dead. So, oops.
And also, the stairs leading up to the gallows are so fucking tall that really, you could have just rolled him off of the platform and he probably would have died.
Yeah.
Like, Betty White could have killed him at that point. He's in an oxygen coma. Uh-huh. Betty White could have lightly kicked him in the chin and he would have died.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So
now then he's being carted off to the hospital when Sonny Chiba's domestic partner, I guess?
A hetero life mate, like Jay and Silent Bob.
Something like this. I don't know, man. Even a hetero life mate, I'm not cleaning their underwear.
In your version, his name is Rakuda. But in the American version, Sonny Chiba's sidekick is named Rat Nose.
Rat Nose.
Rat Nose.
Okay.
So Sonny Chiba and his sidekick Rat Nose set him free as he's being sent to the hospital. As Junjo is being sent to the hospital. In your version, his name is Shikinbaru. That's his last name.
Yeah. And that gets very difficult, especially when you're reading subtitles. Because, like, all you can really do is see the name. You can't get any kind of sense of pronunciation or anything like that.
Yeah.
And when you're looking at the lower part of the screen, it's hard to match that name to the face at the top part of the screen.
Yeah.
You know? So then his domestic partner fights the cops and Sonny Chiba comes and he helps out or no, whatever. The partner did most of the fighting there.
Yeah.
But anyway, the first guy, Jujuwa, whatever, he is in the ambulance. So they take him out and now they have kidnapped him and bring him back to their place or something where he is then revived. And like right there was a chunk that we didn't see. And this was the first part that really lost me because I had no idea who this guy and girl Sonny Chiba was talking to for three viewings. I didn't start getting who the fuck they even were until the third viewing.
That's Junjo's sister and brother.
Right.
And they hired Sonny Chiba to set their brother free.
Mm-hmm.
At least in my version, that's when Sonny Chiba said, I did set him free, but there's no way he can be, like, there's no way a wanted murderer would be here, so he's, like, halfway to Hong Kong or something, but whatever, your brother's not here, but I freed him, give me the money.
Right. Mm-hmm.
I did my part, I set him free, sure, he's not here, sorry he's not here, but he's a killer, what the hell you expect? Anyway, I freed him. Give me the money.
Mm-hmm. The money that it turns out that they do not have.
Yeah.
So they fight.
Yeah. He fights both the sister and the brother.
Yes.
Because he's Sonny Chiba and Sonny Chiba don't give a fuck.
And winds up throwing the brother out the window or the brother goes out the window somehow and falls to his death.
the brother does like a running, leaping, like drop kick. And yeah, it's unclear as to whether Sonny Chiba like throws him mid drop kick through the window or if he just literally just takes a step to the side and the guy ends up taking a header through the window. But either way, he falls out of the window and dies.
Mm-hmm.
And the sister is then sold into the sex trafficking trade.
Yes. Which I found very interesting later on in the movie.
Yeah. Yeah. On our way to Oklahoma City or to Norman, sometimes we pass this sign kind of in between, I guess in Moore, between Moore and Oklahoma City, we pass this sign and it says to like do your part and report any sex trafficking that you see to help stop the sex trafficking trade.
Okay.
But it's a sign like on the side of the road. Like how much sex trafficking do you think a normal person sees in their day that you need a sign right by a stop and a yield sign to remind us that sex trafficking is bad? It's not like they're, it's not like people
and
who
to,
are,
and to be clear, it is. Okay?
Yeah.
It's bad. The Pope on Film comes out against sex trafficking.
That's an exclusive right there. That is an exclusive.
But selling baby parts? We're down with that.
You got to do what you got to do. You got to do what you got to do.
Even if we're talking about the Pope's own baby parts.
Yeah. Got to do what you got to do. Mm-hmm. So, the people that Sonny Chiba sells the chick to try to hire him to kidnap a girl, and this girl is the daughter of like a rich oil tycoon.
Yes. Third largest oil company in the world.
But apparently Sonny Chiba has big trust issues.
He does.
And he's like,
he's been hurt.
But I must trust you. If we do not have trust, how can we work together? We need to be partners. And it, like, okay, this isn't a therapy session, Mr. Chiba. But then as he's trying to leave, they stop him and he discovers that these people who are hiring him, turns out that they are actually members of the Yakuza.
Yes. But anyway, in the short of it, the movie at this point has taken a complete tonal and plot change.
Yes.
And there's nothing about the brother and the sister or the other karate guy. Sorry.
Junjo.
So we go on to this completely new plot line.
Yeah. Where suddenly the Yakuza, suddenly the Yakuza's there and the daughter of an oil tycoon. And so the Yakuza are now trying to kill Sonny Chiba because Sonny Chiba knows about the Yakuza's plan to kidnap the daughter of the rich oil tycoon.
It's Dallas.
Different movie.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Yeah. It's Dallas and suddenly he's the good guy. Like, right. You didn't just kill people and sell a woman to be a prostitute.
Right.
It's like, wait, are you the good guy now? Because you've been an ass.
He's up been to a this total point. Ass.
Now you mean to tell me that you're fighting the evil Yakuza? Because that's a complete, like, 180 or 360 or 720 or some sort of spinning is going on here.
Mm-hmm. And this is totally a part that Bruce Lee would never have played.
Yes, absolutely. Ever. Absolutely. Never would have done it.
Sonny Chiba is a total fuck.
Yeah. So the Yakuza try to kill him and they fail. So since Sonny Chiba knows the plan, he decides to go with his hetero life mate to find the oil daughter.
Mm-hmm.
but she's being guarded by her uncle?
Something like that. There was some kind of relation there.
Her uncle, and he runs a dojo, a kung fu dojo. But Sonny Chiba is Sonny Chiba, and he's like, I'm breaking in here. I'm going to fight all of you.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to fight every one of you. I'm fighting the whole dojo.
Yes.
I am going to now fight this entire kung fu school.
And he did damn well.
He did. Eventually he goes like one-on-one with the fat balding uncle.
Uh-huh.
Because fat balding uncles are always masters at kung fu.
Mm-hmm.
As everyone knows.
And that always bothers me about the bad guys. Not that this guy was really a bad guy, but the bad guys in movies, okay?
Yeah.
How tough are you if you have to wear out the hero with all of your henchmen first?
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, I mean, I think if we took Mike Tyson, okay? Because I just watched a documentary about him the other day. We take Mike Tyson, okay? And we make him fight 30 other professional boxers back to back.
And then George Foreman.
And then at that point, I could kick his ass, I think.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know?
God, my parents would... they would get like every other Mike Tyson pay-per-view boxing match because they honestly, oh, well, this one's going to be a difficult one for him, Stevie.
And they never were. I hate
this one's going to be a difficult one. This one's going to be a big one. This guy's going to be a real challenger. This guy's going to be, oh, wait, it's already done.
Yeah. This documentary was actually about Evander Holyfield.
Yeah.
You know, but that was the spin on it. The Evander Holyfield Tyson, and that's what it was called. It was called Chasing Tyson.
Hmm.
You know?
Yeah.
And I hated Tyson, so I always wanted to see Holyfield just bury him.
I love Mike Tyson now only because I have been watching his cartoon.
He has a cartoon?
It's on Adult Swim. It's one of those like 11-minute cartoons.
Yeah.
And it's just a picture-perfect Scooby-Doo parody called the Mike Tyson Mysteries. He has a mystery van. He has an adopted young Chinese daughter who is really smart.
Yeah. Wears glasses?
Yes. Wears glasses. Velma.
Okay.
He has a pet, but the pet is actually a pigeon because he's like a pigeon fancier. Mike Tyson is.
Yeah.
He raises pigeons and stuff. But the pigeon is actually Mike Tyson's friend who accidentally got put in the body of a pigeon, and he's a drunk and an asshole, and it's voiced by Norm MacDonald.
Okay.
And for some reason
who
they
always sounded like an asshole and is perfect for a cartoon.
Yeah. And for some reason they're all joined by the ghost of the Marquis of Queensberry.
Okay.
Who is voiced by the dean of the college in the show Community. And it's just a perfect Scooby-Doo parody, except Mike Tyson is voiced by Mike Tyson, and he has a Mike Tyson voice, and sometimes he's stupid, and sometimes he has no idea what he's doing, and it's wonderful. It's more Scooby-Doo than Scooby-Doo. And
really?
It's perfect. It's really dirty and offensive and great. It's only 11 minutes long, and I am just in absolute love with it. It's a great show.
Or any on YouTube?
I don't think so. I don't know. I don't know. I haven't checked.
I might have to track that down.
But it's called The Mike Tyson Mysteries, and it's really stupid. It's really stupid, and I love it. I've been obsessed with it for a couple of weeks now.
He has mellowed with old age, thank God, but...
Yeah, he has.
Man, what a screaming asshole he was.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely. The thing I like about the fight that Sonny Chiba has with his... the uncle...
Uh-huh.
Is that... he has one of those Peter Parker moments.
I have a different description for it, but yeah, we're in the same ballpark.
Because there's always that part in like 1960s, 1970s Spider-Man comic books where, oh no, Spider-Man is trapped. He can't do it. He's going to give up. Oh, wait, I need to think about Mary Jane. I can't let her down. And what about Aunt May? I need to do it for her. Mm-hmm. Maybe I can get up the fortitude and strength. He did it. He got free.
Yes.
And that's totally what Sonny Chiba does here. Because he's beaten in the match, and then he thinks of his father being killed and his father's last words, and that gives him the strength, and he like hulks up like Hulk Hogan.
But and, but in that flashback,
it's a fucked up flashback.
I was thinking Magneto.
Yes, it is very Magnetian.
Mm-hmm.
Very Magnetoian.
Yeah.
A lot
so
of
that's we were in the same ballpark going on there, and you're completely right with your assessment.
Yeah.
But it had that very concentration campy feel about it.
Yeah. So they fight to like a standstill, and they're talking in the back, and Sonny Chiba, against the daughter's wishes, Sonny Chiba pretty much gets the Kung Fu Dojo to agree to hire him to protect the girl.
Yes.
And of course, he wants to protect them because he hates punks worse than anything.
Yes, but that's not the real reason.
Yeah. The real reason is...
he wants her money.
Yeah. Yeah. Because he's an asshole.
He's a total asshole.
Big, big asshole in this movie. But I love him in this movie. It's weird because it's like, okay, he's really horrible and sold a woman to be a prostitute. But God, I love this man. The weird thing is, too, is that Junjo,
yes,
the karate master from the beginning, he comes back round about this point.
Yes.
And his motives are also justified.
Yes.
If anything, Junjo almost becomes the hero because, God damn it, Junjo should kill Sonny Chiba.
Yes, okay, but now, okay, so he is, I imagine he's hiding out in Hong Kong.
Yeah.
It wasn't very clear where he was, and he is kind of hiding out in this bar or whatever it is. Cops come in looking for him. And the, like, owner of the bar, who is, like, the master of his clan, defends Junjo from the police.
Yeah.
And says he's the law in this town. Then goes to reward Junjo. They negotiate a little. And so he's going to be this guy's bitch. And so because of that, he's going to gift him with one of the prostitutes, who turns out to be his sister.
Yeah.
Who then tells him about the death of his brother. He is all broken up about the death of his brother, but does not seem to give a shit that this clan has been raping the fuck out of his sister.
Yeah, doesn't seem to care too much about that.
God knows how long.
Doesn't really care too much. Maybe it's maybe he wants his sister to be a prostitute. Maybe it's a Spoils of Babylon situation.
Possibly, but now he wants to join this clan.
Yeah.
So he is asking the master to give him a job. Now the master was there and has heard all of this. Okay. So
yeah.
Now he is asking if Junjo or whatever, if he can kill Sonny Chiba.
Yeah. Because apparently...
And that is such poor negotiation skills. You know, you don't negotiate on what the dude has already said he's going to do.
Yeah.
And make that your favor.
Yeah.
You know, that's kind of like, honey, you're going to eat those M&Ms? I would like you to eat those M&Ms for me. What the fuck?
Yeah. Yeah. It's silly.
So anyway, now he's on a mission to go kill Sonny Chiba.
Yeah. So the girl, the oil girl, gets kidnapped. And then they use construction equipment to throw Sonny Chiba's car, just straight toss it off a bridge.
Mm-hmm.
Just straight up, woo, throws the car off the bridge. And now Junjo has a team with him.
Yes.
He's got this whole team because he's got this weirdo blind guy helping him. He's got a crew now.
Yes, he does.
But
he's Capo of the Yakuza.
Yeah. Sonny Chiba survives the car being thrown off of a bridge because he's the number one guy. Because of what his dad told him before he was shot.
Mm-hmm.
Trust no one. Become the number one guy. The American version is so much better. I watched the better version.
Oh, I thought you were... Is that what it sounded like? Because I thought you were doing Jack Palance Batman impersonation.
Oh, no. Terry, remember this. Do not trust anyone. Become a number one guy. That's the actual voice of his father talking to him in the flashback during the fight.
That's pretty awesome.
Yeah. Jack Palance was his father. So he ends up rescuing the girl, but then they kidnap Sonny Chiba.
Right.
And they torture him in the worst way that someone could ever torture someone else. Forget waterboarding. Mm-hmm. The worst torture ever. You tie someone to a tree and hit him with a stick.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Whoa.
It was heart-wrenching.
Whoa, is that a stick? And you're hitting him with it while he's tied to a tree? That's torture right there.
It was much like the end of Old Yeller.
Yeah. It was difficult to watch. It was sad.
And we have another Old Yeller moment coming up later.
Oh, yeah. So, he's being tortured. Ratface, Rat Nose, his sidekick, tries to save him. But then, of course, they capture him because he's the sidekick.
Right.
And they get the sidekick to, like, give up where he stashed the girl against Sonny Chiba's orders.
Mm-hmm.
And so they try to kill Sonny Chiba and, like, shoot him, whatever, throw him off a cliff, and Rat Nose comes to save him, and Sonny Chiba's still alive. But then Sonny Chiba breaks up with him.
Yes. And it was very sad. But at least Sonny Chiba did not send him a text.
Yeah, because that's just not cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but Sonny Chiba definitely broke up with him.
Which is sad.
In a very harsh way.
Yeah. So they re-kidnap the girl. Sonny Chiba tries again to save him. Sonny Chiba tries again to save the girl. The girl's busy getting raped by this big black guy. And Sonny Chiba straight up castrates him.
That was a good scene.
Using his kung fu prowess.
Uh-huh.
Using his, what was the original title of the movie? Using his Clash Killer Fist.
Rip those testicles right the fuck off.
Yeah. Was this before the rape or after the rape? No, this was after the rape. Sonny Chiba tries again to save the girl, but then the blind guy.
Yes.
Is there. And I think that this is interesting because the fight with the blind guy is shortly before the ending of the film. And the thing that really worries me about the end of this film is the drastic change in weather.
Uh-huh.
Because Sonny Chiba's fighting this blind guy, bright sunny day. He goes to the boat to save the girl. Getting dark, still not a cloud in the sky. Finally, he gets to the fight at the end, and it is a goddamn typhoon. suddenly, an El Nino magically shows up.
Mm-hmm.
Rains the crap out of. But that I understand, because if there's going to be a fight between two rivals, it's going to rain in Japan.
Yes.
Because it always rains in Japan if A, two kung fu rivals are going to have a fight, or two, if Godzilla shows up. That's just science.
Mm-hmm.
That is just science.
This is true. But nobody wants to accept it, just like climate change. You know.
Yeah, just like climate change. So the blind guy is kind of winning. He's using the light and his sword to blind Sonny Chiba. But then a motorcycle appears.
Yes.
And,
uh-huh.
And tries to hit the blind guy, or at least distract the blind guy. Whatever, the motorcyclist isn't doing a good job and gets sworded in the stomach.
Yes.
Gets cut. But in the time that the blind guy is distracted by the guy in the motorcycle, Sonny Chiba comes along and Sonny Chibas him up, kills the guy.
Mm-hmm.
And then Sonny Chiba goes to the motorcyclist. And who is it? It's old man Willoughby, who runs the haunted amusement park.
Yes, it is. And if he would have gotten away with it if it wasn't for those damn meddling kids.
Yep, if it wasn't for those meddling kids.
Mm-hmm.
No, it's Rat Nose.
It is Rat Nose.
And he died trying to save his buddy / lover / hetero life mate, Sonny Chiba. Asks him, like, oh, now we can be together. Please don't leave me. I'm your friend. Whatever. I'm going to die now. Eh. And Sonny Chiba cries a silent tear.
Now, I am. Yes, he did. I was wondering through a lot of this movie if that may be like some kind of a trope of Sonny Chiba movies.
Crying a silent tear, or
no, having this strange kind of sidekick. Because it really gave me a Kill Bill vibe when I was watching the opening of this movie. Because that was kind of the same bar scene with Sonny Chiba and the other guy that he kept arguing with the whole fucking time.
Yeah. I read in a couple of kung fu websites that a lot of Kill Bill was taken from Sonny Chiba movies, especially Sonny Chiba's The Street Fighter, which makes sense because of the beginning of True Romance.
Mm-hmm.
Specifically, I heard that when he arrives on the boat and basically fights an entire boatload of people, especially fighting them while going up and down stairs, that a lot of that is the bride versus the crazy 88 in Kill Bill.
Yeah.
And which I never picked up on until I watched it this last time.
And there was one thing that this movie was really missing. If it was there, I wasn't seeing much of it. There wasn't a lot of street fighting. There wasn't a lot of streets.
There was apartment fighting.
Uh-huh.
There was
jail fighting.
There was side of a bridge fighting.
Uh-huh.
There was kind of like how there isn't a bucket of blood in a bucket of blood. There's like a quarter sized saucepan of blood.
Yes.
But not a real bucket.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Blood.
There's Kung Fu Dojo fighting.
Yes.
The fight with the blind guy is really alleyway fighting. It's not street fighting. It's alley to the side of the street fighting.
Exactly.
And then finally, boat fighting.
Yes.
But yeah, not a lot of street fighting.
I would imagine that when Jimmy John was in the ambulance and Ratface beat up the cops to get him.
Junjo.
That was kind of a street fight because it was a car and it was on the street.
But Sonny Chiba
wasn't fighting that one.
Yeah, Rat Nose is the only real street fighter in this movie.
Yeah. It's
fought on the street. So, Rat Nose dies, but he dies as a buddy with Sonny Chiba. So Sonny Chiba's all pissed off. He goes to the boat where they have the oil chick, trying to get her to sign off her entire oil company's money to the Yakuza. He shows up at the boat and fights everyone Crazy 88 style.
Yes.
The weather goes insane. And finally, the bad guys are like, okay, everybody stop. We're gonna settle this in the following way. Junjo's gonna fight Sonny Chiba to the death. If Sonny Chiba wins, sure, we'll let him have the girl and he can get out of here. Fine. That's fine.
Mm-hmm.
We're gonna stop fighting you. We're gonna stop letting you kill us.
Yes.
But we're just gonna end it this way. You two fight, whoever wins. I hope that they kept their promise, because it kind of ends immediately after the end of the fight. There's still the whole, yeah, you won the fight, but you're still on our boat, and we're not going to let you the fuck off of this boat.
Yeah.
In fact, once you win the fight, we'll probably, yeah, I'm just going to shoot you now. Because they're the Yakuza. They're not goddamn Boy Scouts.
I really kind of lost it at the end here. And it was like, okay, Sonny Chiba fights a bunch of guys and kind of sort of wins.
Well, earlier when Junjo and the sister meet up with Sonny Chiba, Sonny Chiba grabs the sister and is like, I will kill her. And Junjo's kind of all like, go ahead and kill her, because we are so about fucking killing you, Sonny Chiba. We are so hard on with revenge against you that she would gladly give her life if it means me killing you.
Yes.
So it's the end fight. It's Junjo versus Sonny Chiba. In the end, the girl jumps into the middle of the fight, and she is in between Junjo and Sonny Chiba.
Uh-huh.
And Junjo has one of those sighs like Elektra from Daredevil.
Uh-huh.
And she basically says, stab him through me. It's okay. I'm going to give my life, but...
Which is so stupid.
Yes, it is stupid.
Classic stupid.
Junjo... Okay. Killed his sister.
Yeah, so yes, he does this. But she had a grip on him. That's all that needed to happen here. He could have stabbed him through the fucking ear or anywhere else and avoided killing his sister.
And also, I don't care how long the sigh is, it takes a lot of length from the sigh to stab through a person to stab someone else. How many inches is that sigh going through Sonny Chiba if it already went through your sister?
Yeah.
I don't care how skinny she is. It's going to take up a lot of space on that sword from the sister. Unless you've got like some crazy ass like 5 foot long sigh, but you don't have that.
Yeah, exactly. And his scythe was clearly not big enough.
Yeah. So he stabs Sonny Chiba through his sister. His sister dies, and Sonny Chiba's all like struggling there and on the floor and bleeding and about to die. And Junjo kind of stands on top of him, and he's about to give this like death blow. But on his way down to punch Sonny Chiba, with like his last ounce of strength, raises an arm up and grabs the bad guy by the throat and does his Clash Killer Fist.
Yes.
And rips out the guy's vocal cords and stands up with this guy's, with a chunk of this guy's neck innards in his hand, and a really abrupt ending.
Uh-huh.
He literally just rips out a piece of the guy's neck, stands up, end of film.
Uh-huh. Exactly.
But I am happy to say that Return of the Street Fighter, which isn't as good but is still pretty good, does feature the return of Junjo.
It does, okay.
Yeah. He survived the fight on the boat. He is now talking with a voice box, but he does return seeking revenge against Sonny Chiba. And blames Sonny Chiba for the death of his brother and sister, although at least 50% of that revenge should be directed towards the mirror, because he killed his sister.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. But interesting note that Junjo does come back and come back for revenge.
They really missed an opportunity, I think, there. I haven't seen the second one, of course, but they really should have had the sister kind of Obi-Wan it, you know?
Oh, that would have been nice.
Yeah.
That would have been a nice touch. But I think the big question that the Street Fighter raises is, did Sonny Chiba get rid of all the punks?
Well, if there was a sequel, he couldn't have.
Yeah, he couldn't have. He could not have.
I hate punks worse than anything.
Oh, worse than anything.
Mm-hmm.
Worse than paper cut. Worse than, I hate punks worse than you have a paper cut, but you don't know about it, and then you use hand sanitizer.
Oh.
And then your cut starts, oh, I have these three cuts I didn't know about, and now it stings. I hate that, but you know what I hate more than that? Punks. Punks. Uh-huh. Hate punks more than that. Oogie loves? Hate Oogie that. Loves.
Mm-hmm.
I hate that. But one thing I hate more than Oogie loves, punks.
Punks.
Hate punks worse than anything. Anything.
Anything. Well, because they're punks.
Yeah, they're punks. I hate them. Hate them worse than anything. I love this movie. And I'd like to think that it shows in the episode. I love this movie.
I think it does.
Good.
I think it's getting a lot of love.
Good. You should watch the English dubbed version, because I hate it when America dubs a kung fu movie or some Japanese action movie, because they always do a bad job. But this is such a bad, gritty grindhouse movie that I like the American dubbed version, because it just kind of adds to the sort of grime of the film. I see the bad, really bad American dubbing of this film the way I kind of see the fake scratches and pops in the movie Grindhouse. It's supposed to be there. It's supposed to be a bit bad.
Yes.
And the bad dubbing, especially in the beginning with the security guards, the guards in the prison, in the American version, literally their voice changes mid-sentence.
Junjo, you have a visitor. He is a priest from Okinawa. He has come to save you.
Like, literally, in a second, the voice will change to a completely different actor while the same one person is talking. And it's wonderful. Adds to the movie. Adds to it. Great, great film.
one day we're still going to have to do Ricky Yo.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. One day we will have to do that. But I think that next week, in order to appease the pregnant woman in my house, I think that we should do Rosemary's Baby.
Let's do that.
Yeah, especially since I have never sat through the movie.
Really?
I've seen the ending a bajillion times. I've seen the ending a couple of times. I used to be obsessed with this horror movie compilation film called Terror in the Aisles. It was a 1980s movie that was a compilation of scenes from other horror movies.
Uh-huh.
And it was hosted by... It was hosted by... What was the name of the guy who was the doctor in... Donald Pleasance.
Yes.
It was from 1984, and it was a documentary film about horror movies, and it just featured clips of the scariest scenes from, like, Jaws and Halloween and The Thing and The Shining and Psycho. Frogs, Carrie, Exorcist, Rosemary's Baby, Marathon Man, Is It Safe? And a bunch of other horror movies.
Uh-huh.
And for some weird reason, I had a copy of it at home, and I would watch it all the time, just constantly.
Hmm.
And the movie basically features the entire ending of Rosemary's Baby. So I've seen the ending a bajillion times.
I think I might have seen it. It sounds kind of familiar.
What, Terror in the Aisles?
Yes.
Yeah.
I've definitely seen Rosemary's Baby. It's a great movie.
Yeah, I have not. I absolutely have not. So I'm excited to sit down and watch this all the way through. This will be interesting.
Yes, it should. It's really one of the few Roman Polanski movies that I like. I'm not a huge Roman Polanski fan.
Oh, yeah, Roman Polanski. Is this before or after the rape?
This would have been before.
Yeah, okay.
It was shot at the Dakota, which is where John Lennon was killed.
Yes.
And there's a lot of nice, fun conspiracy theory surrounding Rosemary's Baby because of that.
Yeah.
And the Manson connections and all that, and Roman Polanski was really a big Satanist and all these great things.
Yeah. So next week we're doing Rosemary's Baby. I will try and watch the movie with a pregnant woman, which I'm hoping will add to the film.
How about I see if Alyssa will come over, because she's about to pop like any day now.
Alyssa? Ah. So, like, two pregnant women.
Yeah, why not?
Wow.
I'd be like, listen, let's watch Rosemary's Baby.
Well, how about this, honey? For the podcast, what if I get a third woman pregnant? What if I get someone else pregnant just so that we can have three pregnant women?
Okay, I'm going to say the problem with that would be we wouldn't know.
So,
but the thing is that we wouldn't find out until the week after.
Okay, you're right. I shouldn't get another woman pregnant.
If you were trying to get another woman pregnant, you would have to put Rosemary's Baby off at least 2 to 3 weeks.
Oh, yeah, that's not going to happen.
And then she would totally be in the first trimester. I'm sick. I'm tired. I don't want to do a goddamn thing.
Yeah.
So.
And I hate that. I mean, I love that, and it's fine, and you're
the
best.
I know you hate it.
Okay.
It's cool. I hated it, too.
Okay. And the homework for next week, honey, is this video here called Mass of Daddy Long Legs. You see that bush there on the log?
No.
It's not a bush. It's like 500 Daddy Long Legs. Hmm. You want to know what happens when a guy pokes it with a stick? I'm not going to show it to you right now. It's but yeah, it's pretty messed up. It happens in Nogales, Arizona. It happens in Nogales.
Figures.
Yeah. So that's next week. Yeah. Do we have a contest, good sir?
We have a contest. Jeannie has not gotten home yet, so I'm going to have to call the name myself. It's snowing pretty bad here, so she's being really super cautious.
Good.
That's what some of that texting back and forth was. Somebody might have heard. I don't know.
Hey, everybody. I'm Dabney, the fucking alien. I thought maybe I should fill you in a bit more about the weekly drawings that we have here at Undead Cow Studios. You can win a 2-DVD set of Bob's Dirty Shorts, but you have to live in the continental United States because Undead Cow Studios is too fucking cheap to mail anything over goddamn seas. Fucking bigoted bastards they are. Well, they do tell me that they are working on some things where maybe it could be downloaded directly off of the website if you win and you are not in the United States. So that's something to look forward to.
In a state noted for strength.
Okay. All right.
No, it's okay. An hour of change and challenge.
I'm trying to...
In a decade of...
Okay. All right. I gotta tell the people about...
The greater our knowledge increases...
Go away.
The greater our ignorance unfolds.
And fix me a sandwich while you're at it.
That most of the scientists...
Okay, so entering the contest is easy. If you see an ad for one of our qualifying products, it should either be the Pope on Film or Bob's Dirty Shorts, and you like it, you're automatically entered into a drawing. If you decide to share it, you're entered into a drawing twice. If you see the same ad over on Twitter, you retweet it, you're entered into the contest again. So you can enter as many times as you like. Just keep liking, sharing, commenting on the stuff that you see out there from Undead Cow Films.
But condense, if you will, the 50,000 years of man's recorded history in a time span of half a century. Stated in these terms,
Mazel tov.
We know very little about the first 40 years.
Faye Ray. Janet Lee. Adrian King. Heather Langenkamp. Amy Steele. That weatherman who saw the cockroach.
Oh my god!
Jamie Lee Curtis. And you. Come on. You know you wanna. Let her rip.
Oh my god!
There. Now don't you feel better? You are now officially a Scream Queen. Come play with the rest of us at www.screamqueens.com. That's Queens with a Z. Or you could subscribe to us on iTunes. Either way. It's gonna be fucking fabulous. The Scream Queens Horror Podcast. It's where horror gets bent.
But I have the hat. I am shaking the hat. And I am pulling a name from the hat. And it is 9 volt DC.
Yay!
And we are going to pull another name out of a hat for the second chance. And it is More XP Gaming.
All right, More XP Gaming.
Yay!
Congratulations, More XP Gaming.
We have been doing pretty good with finding people and getting the discs out to them, so I'm really happy with that. I contacted La La France. who was last week's winner, and she was really excited. I also got in touch with Jeff O'Brien and Richard Corso, and both of those, their discs are going out to them already. So we've been doing good with that.
Good. I am glad to hear it. I'm a bit distracted right now because I'm trying to put together Immortal Kombat as a nice little playlist featuring an aged Sonny Chiba. So I'm working on that. So hopefully that will be popping up soon.
Good.
But I think that this has been a good episode.
This has been a good episode. This has been a very good episode.
Sorry for my lack of involvement.
Yes, your lack of involvement, honey, was difficult. But, you know, in your honor, we really pulled together, I think, and we came up with a pretty good episode, I think.
Good.
We rallied.
We rallied, honey.
I know, I add that extra spice.
You do, that extra zavouv. That extra.
We were almost out of it. Okay, this particular episode was down for the count for a little while, and then the podcast flashed on when they killed our father.
Yeah,
and that gave us super strength for us to get up again.
Yes.
and knock it over the fence.
Yeah, the podcast. You know, we got the strength to become the number one guy.
I'm impressed and happy for you both.
Thank you. It's a good episode. It's a good episode. Darn good episode.
Darn good episode. So until next week, I am Bunny Williams.
And I am Reverend Steve. Thanks for listening, everybody. Thanks for supporting the podcast. And we will see you next week, you godless heathens.
You douche waffles and poopy toots.
Yeah, thank you for saying the one for Maxwell. Thank you for carrying the ball there. Cut and print.
Cut and...
That was a terrific episode. Paul, your second act monologue nearly gave me the chills.
Paramount Pictures presents.
Hey, let's make love.
Mia Farrow. Co-starring John Cassavetes.
Let's have a baby.
Oh, Roll, honey, for God's sakes, don't cry,
right? I won't.
Wonderful, well, you're young and healthy. You'll have lots of children.
Madame and Monsieur shall have the dessert after all. Mousse au chocolat, or as many calls it, chocolate mouse.
It's delicious. It has an undertaste. A chalky undertaste.
Hey.
Nice.
Sleep is what you need. Good night's sleep.
You better go down below, miss.
This is no dream. This is really happening.
Written for the screen and directed by Roman Polanski. From the best-selling novel by Ira Levin, Ruth Gordon, Sidney Blackmer, Morris Evans, and Ralph Bellamy. In a William Castle production. Rosemary's Baby.